Okay, you should be live with all cameras for the first time on a Sunday night. Are you guys in the Twitch? I forgot to ask if you were in there.
Headed that way.
Yeah, man.
But we are in there, and if people who are tuning in will notice, this is not Call of Cthulhu. Well, it is Call of Cthulhu, but it's a different Call of Cthulhu. We are doing Fall of Delta Green tonight because we are down two of our regular players, and we are getting very close to wrapping up New York, so we don't want to do that without them. There's a chance of it. Thanks, fun. Oh, I can hear someone's Twitch or something again. All right, there we go.
Everybody gets in there.
There's some music going on there. We're gonna get DMCA strike or something. Some music. Yeah, so we're down two players, so we figured let's do something else. So we're sticking with the A Cthulhu theme and B historical theme because that seems to be, working well for us on Sunday nights with the 1920s Cthulhu. So we're gonna do the Fall of Delta Green, which is a eldritch setting, set in the, oh, I'd say 1950s to 1970. Is it 1970 or 1973 is the fall of Delta Green? I can't remember off the top of my head. I was reading the
I think
time.
70.
Is it 70? Yeah, the timelines. Something goes terribly wrong in Cambodia and is covered up by the attacks in Cambodia during the Vietnam War, and that is the fall of Delta Green. So we're taking place in 1967 during the Vietnam War. During the events, and I'll do a little intro on what Delta Green is for folks who aren't aware, and then we'll get into it. We'll do a little introduction of characters. We're playing a one shot tonight from the back of the Fall of Delta Green book. We've got these guys are using some pre-gens. We're gonna do a little rules rundown before we jump into it. But before we do that, how about we do a little round table and have people plug what they got going on? Because I know there's two people here who are content creators now, with a third on the way, but we'll wait for him. So, Bert, you're up at my left here, and I will get you to go ahead and plug what you've got going on.
Sure, I'm Bert, or BizLab on the intertubes. I have a little podcast called Of Steam, Steel, and Murder, and we play all kinds of games there. You can find us. We're easy to find.
10-year anniversary just happened, right?
No, soon. Another month and a half.
Okay.
Counting down.
Counting down. And Oak down to my bottom left has just started a Twitch channel. What do you got going on there, Oak?
Yeah, right now I'm just getting my feet wet trying to figure out what all this stuff is about. It's twitch.tv/Uriense, Uriense, but I go by Oak. Just playing some PC games off my Steam library, which I've got over 400, so I've got plenty to do there. And then I've got a few RPG campaigns like this one, or a Friday night one, a Saturday night one that I'm streaming as well.
Are you hosting us?
Yeah, I should be hosting.
Cool. I don't know. It doesn't show. Unless it happens during the stream, it doesn't pop up and tell me. All right. And Bill and Nick, you guys don't have anything going on yet, right?
Is correct.
Yet. We'll get
Yet.
Bill started. All right, so how about I do a
Just
little
this.
just this? I'm going to do a little introduction, a little read through of what Delta Green is to introduce folks here on the stream and some of our players, because this is the first introduction to Delta Green for many people. And then from there, we'll do character introductions and we can go on into the adventure. So I'm going to read the blurb from the book here. What is Delta Green? Delta Green is an authorized but unacknowledged black program of United States National Security Establishment. Its personnel are tasked from all branches of federal government, especially from the military, law enforcement, and intelligence communities. The program is classified top secret, with its existence and mission known only to holders of Delta Green clearance. The program has a small, permanent staff deep in the bowels of the Pentagon, but its agents operate in secret. The program buries Delta Green missions inside other ongoing military operations or disguises them as training exercises, liaison work, or entirely unrelated investigations. Delta Green agents hold normal federal postings in the military, CIA, FBI, NSA, or some other agency. Their employers never understand the real mission of the program. Delta Green began with a raid on Innsmouth, Massachusetts, 40 years ago in 1928. That raid revealed a literally apocalyptic threat to the United States and to the world. It gave the federal government a glimpse into a parallel physics and biology of alien gods and immortal monsters. Even the briefest contact with these phenomena destroys the minds and lives. The touch of the unnatural corrupts and poisons those who study it and those who oppose it. Encounters with this implicitly hostile, unutterably incomprehensible universe have leveled civilizations and sunk continents. The mission of Delta Green is to hunt and destroy any and all aspects of this unnatural reality at home and abroad, at any cost. So that's Delta Green. So the fall of Delta Green, you guys are playing within the heyday of Delta Green. It obviously falls by the title of this game, and it goes off the books, and there is a period during the, 1970s to the late 80s, early 90s, when it is officially, unofficially opened up again. Bert ran an excellent game over on Notorious DMG that I played in, and you guys should check that out. I'll put a link to that game in the description, where we played during the what's known as the cowboy years. So Delta Green was closed down and wasn't really happening, but missions were still going on. They were still fighting the fight off the books and unofficially. So we were a couple cowboys, and we sure played it that way. But we're going to be playing in the official sanctioned years. There's another organization I just want to quickly touch on as well, because they may or may not come up, and they're known as Majestic. Majestic deals with aliens and alien technology, and their whole focus is to take that technology and information and biology and weaponize it. So Delta Green and Majestic, they work in conjunction, but they're like uneasy bedfellows, whereas your whole mission is to secretly find it and destroy all this information, related to like Eldritch and occult and things like that. You guys are not comfortable with alien technology either. So there's Majestic and Delta Green. Majestic continues on after this, and they don't have the disgrace that Delta Green does in the next few years. But you guys are uneasy bedfellows in your two secret organizations out of the United States. So any questions about Delta Green itself? Not rules-wise, but the setting? No? All right. We will do a brief rundown of the rules, and forgive me if I mess things up, but we'll do this together. So I'm just going to open up a character sheet here. Folks on the stream, you can't see the sheet, but that's okay. We're just going to do a brief rundown. The way Gumshoe works is it's more of a clues, investigation, deductive type system. And you're going to notice on your character sheet that you've got an ability section, and it's broken down by academic, interpersonal, technical, and general. So the two types of clues are, you've got, or abilities, I'm sorry, you've got the general, and those are like everyday abilities, like driving cars, using athletics to leap from a building to building, using a firearm. And you'll notice that you have points next to some of these abilities. For example, I'm looking at Bobby Brent. You've got an 8 out of 8 athletics. Those are points that you can spend on ability checks. So whenever you make an ability check in this game, it's always a d6. You roll a d6 no matter what, and typically a 4 is a success. Much like, I think it's Savage Worlds, 4 is a success as well, is it not?
Yep.
So typically your target number is a 4. So if you want to increase your chance of success, you can spend some of those points you have. So Bobby, you've got 8. You could, and you add those points you spend onto your roll that you're about to roll. So you do it before you roll the dice, and say you want to spend 2 of your 8 athletics. You take your athletics down to a 6, you roll your d6, and you'd add 2 onto the result. There are ways to gain back those points on general abilities as the game goes on. Now, your other abilities are your investigative abilities, and those fall under academic, interpersonal, and technical. If you have a point in something, for example, under academic, there's anthropology. Bob, you've got 2 points in anthropology. You can use those to get clues in a scene. You don't ever have to roll for those abilities, academic, interpersonal, or technical. They automatically happen. If you're trained in that skill or that specialization, you will automatically pick up or find clues in the scene related to it if you want to use it. But you can also spend additional points. You could spend 2 of those points or 1 of those points, and you can maybe glean additional information or additional clues by spending them. These you won't typically get back as we play through the game, but you're always guaranteed to uncover something in every scene. It's not going to be hidden behind a role. If you have the skill and you put it to use, or you describe how you're going to use it, hey, you get the clue. It just happens. You're never going to fail it. But you can build up further successes by spending those points. And even if you spend the points in any given one where you have points in it, say you have a 0 out of 2 on your anthropology, Bobby, by the time you go into the next scene, you still always have the training in that skill, anthropology, and it'll never go away. You'll always glean anthropology clues in each scene if you rely on it. You just can't spend additional points to get further information based off of those, that skill that you're using or ability you're using to get those clues. Does that make sense?
We're here.
It's a very, very rules light system. It's made to just flow. I'm not hiding clues behind roles. You're never going to fail a roll when it comes to furthering the story. It's just those general abilities that you're going to roll on. Shooting guns, driving, athletics, health, fleeing, first aid, things like that. Sanity, you'll be spending points on to boost your rolls for those. So, then why don't we go ahead and go around and introduce our characters. Everybody has a character sheet, a pre-gen that they have with a name, a branch of the military that they work for, and there should be a little service record / bio for each of them. Go ahead and we'll read those off. And do we want to get into our bonds? When we'll get into bonds. We're not going to bog down the rules. We'll keep it nice and simple to start. So we'll do introductions, who you are, what you work for, who you work for, and your service record and biography. So we'll start the top left again with Bert. You're playing David Nelson. Can you give us an introduction to Mr. Nelson?
Mr. Nelson, Special Agent Nelson, formerly of the Army, now a veteran FBI investigator. I served briefly in post-war Germany, encountered unnatural weirdness while pursuing a serial murderer in my current job.
Serial murderer?
Yeah.
And that drew you into Delta Green. Somehow.
Anything else you want to know about the characters? Motivation? Altruism?
Yeah. Okay, yeah, you're altruistic.
Yep. Which is important, your motivations, because you play to your motivations and it helps you get stuff back.
Right. So,
sorry to interrupt. Where are you guys seeing your bio? My bio and info is blank.
I'm reading from the PDF that he linked in the Discord server.
Yes, all right. You're going to need those PDFs because the character sheet in Roll 20 is not the Fall of Delta Green one, so it can only put so much over.
Gotcha.
So while Nick's getting his, I'm going to jump down to Oak then, and Oak can tell us about Bobby Brent.
Yeah, mine's blank too, except for I'm U.S. Army PsyOps Division.
No, it'll be on the PDF that I linked in the Discord.
I know.
Bill, do you have yours?
My wife's jacking around, so let's try.
Yeah, I can go.
All right, Dr. Vanekar. Vanekar.
I'm playing Dr. Elliot Vanekar. He is a Dutch-American who served on a patrol boat in the Korean War, later becoming a surgeon. I was rescued from a ghoulish corpse thieves by Delta Green. The event that got me into it was my captivity. My motivation is mystery, so I will be very much following the gumshoe type of it, trying to figure out what is going on.
And I want to point something out to you, Bill, on your character sheet. I'm looking at it with you right now as well. On yours, you notice to the right of motivation, it says adapted to when there's violence and helplessness, and you have 3 checks next to helplessness. Or 3 X's next to helplessness.
I do see that. Also, it's worth saying I am ex-Navy.
Ex-Navy. What that means is when it comes to stability checks during this game, you can call on your adaptiveness to helplessness to help you out on those checks. It can actually like reduce the difficulty of them. So some characters have an aptness to violence and others helplessness. I'll jump back up to Unswolf.
So to be clear there, Matt,
yeah.
If I'm in a situation that I can't control, that'll be something I could use helplessness for.
I will tell you, it's usually during an instability check. and those come up. That's kind of like, it's almost like a sanity check. You have hit points, instability, and sanity in this, but the instability is you're creeping towards madness and insanity, and that's what we're going to be testing more than anything, is your stability, trying to keep it together as you uncover things.
Sounds cool. Thank you.
You're welcome. Nick/Onswolf, you are Stan Madison.
Stan Madison, 30 years old, American from the U.S. Army, served one tour in Vietnam, African-American, served one tour in Vietnam. Contact with hostile entity in jungle led to Delta Green recruitment and rotation back to Con U.S. Extreme Violence.
Yes.
What, I'm not sure what that is.
So your inciting an event organization? Was... Yeah, Conus is your organization. Conus. I don't know. There's so many acronyms for organizations in this game, so I can't keep up with all of them. I apologize. But you're adapted to violence. So to the right of your motivation, you got comradeship. Or camaraderie, we'll say, as your motivation. Right. To the right of that, you've got violence, because you spent time in Vietnam not too long ago, and your inciting event was extreme violence. So again, when stability checks come up, you can actually pull on your adaptedness to violence to help you with those checks. Not everybody has this. I think you're the only two pre-gens that have either helplessness or violence that you can pull on from the past. All right, last but not least, we got Bobby Brent.
Okay, Bobby Brent. He's a 28-year-old American in the U.S. Army, worked in the PSYOPs division, and he conducted psychological operations out of Fort Meade and Firebase Chamberlain. Is introduced to Delta Green as a field-qualified expert with hard experience.
Nice, Bobby. What is your... Where are you? So your motivation is duty and your PSYOPs army. Ooh, very good. All right. So the four of you are off wherever you are doing your jobs. I don't know wherever that is across the United States. You're currently doing whatever you do, your day jobs. When you receive a message via courier, you... gets delivered to your place of business, your home, wherever you're at the time, and you open up this message and it just says, you're invited to a day at the races. And you know that this is the call sign for Delta Green. If you get a message that says this, that is the call sign that you are being recruited to go on a mission. Along with this message stating you are invited to a day at the races is a plane ticket leaving from Gate 13 at Los Angeles International in one day's time to Saigon, Vietnam. So you must get your affairs together, pack up, and know that you are now being recruited or now being called by Delta Green organization to go look into some sort of instance overseas. You don't know if it's going to be in Vietnam itself, but you have a ticket and you have to find a way to Los Angeles. I'm going to ask around the table, David, what do you do? How do you tie up your affairs to justify or say why you're all of a sudden leaving for an extended period of time?
Actually, can I break in for just a second?
Yes.
We're playing during the heyday of Delta Green, you said. So we're not an underground conspiracy. This is an actual job.
Well, you do report to the FBI. You're an FBI agent, right?
Yeah.
But it's still unknown that you, like, your superiors don't know that you report to Delta Green.
Okay.
So, you're going to let your superiors know that you're needing some time off? David Nelson?
Oh, that's me.
Yes.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Actually, no, since I am working a case, I'm still tracking that serial killer that got me started on this whole spiral to begin with. So I just put in the paperwork that I'm tracking down a lead.
Nice. Yeah. They go along with that. It makes sense. Stan, how about you? You get the call. What are you going to tell? Do you have a family? Do you have a job? What do you do? And what are you going to say?
I've got... What do I have?
On the second page of all your character sheets, you have bonds. So some of you have families and wives and...
Ah, okay. I've got my old squad mates, my kid sister, and my girlfriend. So I'm telling my my girlfriend's not happy that I'm shipping out again. I'm just busy, you know, going through the routine. I'm packing my gear up. I'm getting my weapons ready, cleaning my weapons, getting my gear, just going through the routine. And I'm having flashbacks of having been out there before, and I'm not really looking forward to going again. But got to do what you got to do.
Right, you see Saigon.
Uncle Sam calls.
Right, you're not happy to be going back. Bobby Brent, what do you got going on?
Assuming since duty is my motivation and it doesn't show otherwise, I'm probably a lifer. And unfortunately, it's that normal procedure around my family. I tell them bye, you know, duty calls. I give them all of my love that I can last couple of days before I head out and get my bug out bag and head to the airport.
All right. And Dr. Vanikar, you work with Veteran Affairs as a physician. You're ex-military. So what are you doing?
Yeah, I've only got to tell my staff that I'm not going to be in and give my mom an excuse. So I'm off to Africa to go fix cleft lips as a surgeon for pro bono work.
There you go. Look at you. You told Edith where you're headed. Here's a number to reach me at.
Mummy, I'm out.
All right, so you guys find your various ways across the country from wherever you are to Los Angeles. And you meet up at Gate 13 the following day. It's just the four of you there. There's a flight attendant standing at the desk. And no one else in the little waiting area. The four of you have never met each other before. You don't know each other. But you know if you're sitting here that you have also been recruited on this mission. So I don't know if... And if you want to make chit-chat or conversation or save that for the plane or save it for the briefing, but you sit there for a couple hours while you await boarding, and then you're shown onto a private jet to take you overseas. Does anybody want to interact or get to know one another, or you just kind of keep to yourselves, loners?
Is anybody else military? Or active military?
Stan Madison might be. He's Army still. He's U.S. Army. He's Urban Intelligence.
Yeah, I'll probably like strike up conversations with him. Nothing specific. Just say, you know, where'd you serve? What, how many tours? Typical kind of stuff.
Right. You're both Army vets.
Well, I make sure to show the airline personnel my ID so I can carry my firearms on board.
Right, so you have what a sidearm?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're all very aware that the four of us are getting on this plane together, though, right? And it'll just be us?
Yes. Oh, yeah. This is not a commercial flight. It is disguised as a commercial flight. The tickets look legit, but you know that if this is a Delta Green operation, then there will be nobody else here. The people who are sitting here right now, the four of you, are the people who should be here.
Okay. Well, if it's private, sure. Have we done missions together?
No, you have not done missions together, the four of you.
I'm going to save most of the talking until we're on the plane, but I'll ask, anybody want a cup of coffee?
Thumbs up. Black full-leaded, please.
Yeah, it's 1967, so you can head on over to the commissary and get yourselves a cup of coffee.
I'll just go grab a bunch of coffees, bring them back, and we can sit in silence and drink coffee then.
I'll grab a bottle of bourbon.
Yeah, sure.
There's a carton of smokes, being the 70s.
Yeah, cigarettes everywhere. Yeah, sitting there smoking cigarettes and in the airport terminal. You
take out a pack of cigarettes and light one up, pass the pack around.
Yeah, I guess that's a old hat for us, eh? Everybody having a coffee and a smoke at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're all wearing suits, you know? It's a sign of the times. Everybody's in a nice full suit. You're sitting around smoking cigarettes. There's ashtrays everywhere. having a drink, having some coffee. And as you're sitting there, you're informed by the flight attendant that dancing in the aisles, the flight is preparing to board. The attendant comes over, doesn't even collect your tickets or anything, just shows you onto the plane, does not ask for identification of any sorts. And you're shown onto a large jet. And again, it is just the four of you that are in there. You're free to take a seat wherever you want. There is nobody else present. You are told by the stewardess that you are, in fact, heading to Vietnam, but instead you're going to Da Nang. So be prepared for a long flight ahead of you. So the plane takes off, and you're in the sky for, oh, I don't know, what is it, 10-12 hour flight there? I can't remember. It's a long time to Vietnam. Very long flight to Vietnam. But you're under the guise of a commercial flight. Heading to Da Nang, I don't know if you guys are familiar, but that is right at the border of the north and the south, and is the hotbed of the fighting that is currently going all over on in Vietnam. I'll throw a map down for all of you. So you know that you're heading right into an active military zone. And Stan, especially you, this does not... You're not looking forward to this at all. I'll drop a map.
Have I been to this part of Vietnam before?
Yeah, you would have served here. So I dropped a map on there. So you're heading right there. It says One Corps and Quang Nam. Just to the right off the coast there is Da Nang. And if you go to the north, that is Ground Zero. That is the border between North and South Vietnam, and that is where the fighting is going on. So you have definitely...
Where my dad was at.
Where about, sorry?
In Quang Tri. That's my father was there in Vietnam.
There you go. So... Washington to Da Nang, 20 hours and 25 minutes. Well, we're going from Los Angeles. So Washington to Da Nang back today with today's jets is 20 hours. So we'll say it's 20 hours from Los Angeles back then to Da Nang. This is the chat. The chat looks up the information for us. They get us the facts, the details. Historical. I love it.
Well, I passed the bottle of bourbon around.
Yeah, it's a long flight. 20 hours. All right, so you guys land in Da Nang, and you land at a really large Air Force base. This is where most of the Air Force operations are staged out of the area for the combat zone, the demilitarized zone north of here. You are shown off the plane, and waiting for you, you're greeted by a woman. She's in her late 30s, short, cropped brown hair. She's in Navy khakis, and she's wearing Lieutenant Commander's tabs, but there is no unit or ship ID tied to them. And she introduces herself. She says, "Hello, gentlemen. My name is Agent Carlson. Welcome to Vietnam. We have a situation here that requires the attention and your services. U.S. Marines recently captured a Viet Cong tunnel complex in One Corps territory in Ju Thang in Quang Tri province near the demilitarized zone. It is believed that they removed something from that tunnel complex, not least because of Corporal Paul Lewis, the unit photographer attached to the local squad, who died of," and she does air quotes, "accidental firearm discharge to his head 2 days later." That was 3 days ago. Your mission is to investigate the possible outbreak of unnatural and prevent it from damaging the war effort. Or the world. Or even further. There's something unnatural that has been uncovered there in those tunnels, and we need you to find out what it is, and either destroy it or bring it back. We can't have this fall into the VC's hands. We damn well can't have this fall into Majestic's hands. So you need to go head to Firebase Jonas. That is where the squad is currently situated. talk to the squad mates, find out what the hell went on there, find out why the photographer blew his face off, and get your hands on that artifact. Do you understand?
So it's an artifact.
An artifact of some sort. We don't have too many details. It's fuzzy. It seems to have gone missing also. We can't locate it within Firebase Jonas.
We got a description for this artifact.
It was described
as size, bigger than a bread box, larger than a TV. How movable is this thing?
The rumors we heard was it was a lantern or a lamp of some sort. Some sort of ancient lamp. 24 inches tall, about 12 inches wide. We don't know the exact description. The photographer who took his life also destroyed the photographs he took of the artifact. We just know it was a lamp or a lantern of some sort. Ancient construction.
What's the timetable? When did this occur, and when did it go missing?
So, he shot himself 2 days ago. This is now day three since that incident. So, 3 days ago, the object went missing. We don't know where, or how, or who took it. So you can go there, you can meet with Captain James Rickard, who is the commanding officer of Firebase Jonas, and he can help you. He can direct you to the other squad mates of Corporal Paul Lewis's, the photographer who took his own life and saw this thing last. And hopefully you can piece together what has happened to it and where its current whereabouts are.
Do the police get involved? Is there a police report of the action?
Military police have been kept out of this. We've kept it hush-hush. Thankfully, they're on the front lines.
Do we have a way to get over to the unit that found this first?
I've arranged for a Huey to take you there immediately.
Makes sense to me, guys. What do you think? Get on the Huey and go?
Move out.
All right. She supplies you with sidearms if you don't already have them. And says, I'm not expecting too much resistance. The VC had been pushed back in recent days, and you're going to be at a camp, at a base, a makeshift base. So you should be fine. Is there anything else you require for equipment?
By the look of it, I think I do need a sidearm.
I put sidearms on everybody's character sheets already. Filled it in, knowing that you were going to be given one at the beginning of this operation. But yeah, she asks you if there's anything else you want to requisition before heading off to the front lines.
I've done psyops and stuff like that, and I'm also looking here. I've got a 6 in psychotherapy, if there's any kind of pharmaceuticals I may need to help pry information out of anybody.
Yes.
I'll request for those.
So there's whole sections and information regarding the drugs that are being introduced that time. You know, they refer to them as mother's little helpers in this, but we've got, you know, there's LSD and all kinds of other things, tranquilizers and Quaaludes and all sorts of things have been introduced at this time and being developed. So what is it that you would be looking for?
A little bit of everything. Don't know what I
want. A little bit of a toxic cocktail.
Need a canister of Agent Orange, please.
Yeah.
I would probably like a field medical kit.
Yeah, you're supplied with a medical kit as the medic. There's one waiting for you.
I don't think they call it this yet, but a Zoocyte kit, basically a forensics kit.
Okay. Yeah, that's all things that are readily available here on the Air Force Base. You get the Necronomicon, Fawn asks in chat. Can we have the Necronomicon, please?
And well, they give it to you, but then they would shoot us afterwards.
Chat is also saying an M60. Yeah, you guys aren't given machine guns. At this point, nobody's asked for one, but M16.
How about a grenade or two? Seriously.
Yeah.
Know how the grenades go around here in this group.
Sure, David, you've asked for a grenade. Why don't we...
As much explosives as we can carry.
Yeah, right? So you want to requisition that so you can lean on things to try and get... So that's a little out of the ordinary for what you're being sent. There's someone to send you in there low-key, ask around and such. Showing up with some grenades in your pockets or hanging off your belt is a little intimidating. So you can lean on like something like bureaucracy or... I'm just looking at character sheets here, something else that would work for you. And you can make a roll to try and convince them why you need or why grenades are necessary. Your FBI.
Yeah, I'll do that. I'll put in the paperwork for it, knowing my way around bureaucracy. I'll spend one of my five to get a plus one to the roll.
Sounds good. Yeah, so go ahead and just hit the bureaucracy word or button or whatever it is on your character sheet, and it'll ask you, it'll prompt you to put a plus on there. You just put a one.
Oh, yeah, here we go. I didn't even look at the character sheet. Bureaucracy.
You've got a five in bureaucracy.
Yeah, but it says zero on my character sheet.
Does it really? Did I say?
Yeah, I'm just going to hit a button here.
Yeah,
you know what? It's bureaucracy is down. It's like been entered in manually.
Yeah, it's down at the very bottom of general. A lot of the skills in this don't transfer over from Trail of Cthulhu, and they're
time. Well, I fail. So apparently, I don't do the paperwork right.
Yeah. So. Yeah, so you're sitting there and you're trying to justify some grenades, and Agent Carlson says, "No, I don't think that's necessary. I think we want to go a little bit more low key. Hence the sidearms, something a little bit more concealable. You're going there to investigate on behalf of the army, so we don't need to go around flashing weapons and heavy artillery."
Ah, fair enough, sir. Just being this close to an active military zone, you never know when one of those room cleaners might have come in handy, but I understand your hesitation.
Yes. Is there anything else that you're needing?
I think if we need any heavy weapons or demolitions, we'll be able to get it in the field anyway.
Yes, demolitions will be available in the field, and there's plenty of heavy machine guns available. Every man out there is its general issue. Unfortunately, those boys are dropping daily.
All right, what's the ETA on this Huey?
Huey is ready. She points over to Huey sitting there on the tarmac, waiting for you. It's ready when you are, gentlemen.
All right, I start walking towards it.
Head that way.
All right, you guys board the Huey and get in and start making your way to the front lines. Quan Tree? Is that how you said it?
Yeah, Quang Tree.
It's fairly uneventful. You guys fly there from Da Nang. You do see some outcroppings, and it looks like some remnants of battles along the way that have taken place. Some skirmishes. There's burnt fields. You fly over some locals' villages. Fly over some military personnel that are set up along the way. But it takes about an hour, and you guys make your way to Firebase Jonas up there in Quang Tri. You land there at the designated landing area, and you're greeted by a gentleman in army fatigues who's wearing the rank of captain. He's an older gentleman. He looks like he's in his early 50s. He looks like probably a career military sort of man. He comes over and greets you after the Huey, after you guys get off the Huey, and introduces himself as Captain James Rickard. Gentlemen, step into my tent and I will brief you on the situation we have here at Firebase Jonas on the front lines, if you will.
Sir, yes, sir.
Shows you to his tent. Inside his tent, there's not much in there. There's a cot. There's a table with maps laid out on it, and that's about it. And everybody here in the camp is living pretty sparsely, being out on the front lines. There's not a lot to this camp as you walk your way through and towards his tent. He hunkers down at the table. He leans over and he looks at the group of you and he says, 6 days ago, a platoon of military Marines on night patrol under Lieutenant Gus Van Ryan discovered a VC tunnel complex 18 clicks northwest of the base. Drove off them VCs, and they They uncovered that damn tunnel. A day later, a squad led by Sergeant Porter Jackson went into the tunnels, which turned out to be empty. They didn't appear to connect to a larger complex or anything. We thought at first maybe the VCs were using these as a way to get around and led to some sort of base. We thought we had gotten lucky, but no, it looks like they were just digging them, and they led to nowhere. So what is it exactly you gentlemen are here to find out regarding it?
It's a retrieval mission, sir.
Retrieval of what?
That's what we have to find out. Some sort of possible device.
Hold on a second. Are we... not everybody is privy to what goes on with Delta Green.
That's the other thing, yes.
This man is?
Yes, thank you, Bert, for pointing that out. Yes, Delta Green is a top secret organization, so just because this man's in the military... does not.
Sir, I'm sorry, sir, but that is beyond... that is need-to-know information.
There may be a piece of enemy technology that could help turn the tide over in this war.
Technology on the front lines? What would that be? There's nothing up here. Nothing in those tunnels? Nothing going on?
We're not at liberty to discuss why we're looking for it, sir.
Well, I'll tell you what. Nothing's been removed. And that boy's death was an accident. That's what I told the last guy that was here. So what the hell are you doing here?
What last guy, sir?
Some Air Force puke was here. Brent Mormon was his name. He was here a day before the group of you. I told him the same thing. There's nothing here.
He was not authorized to be there, sir. I need some more information on this man. Who did he say he was working for, and who was his chain of command?
If you guys want, if you have points in HUMINT, it's called. It's human intelligence, but it's one word, HUMINT, on your character sheets. You can leverage that here to get some more information. It's underneath interpersonal abilities. So, just having HUMINT, you can tell that he's lying. He's lying about the last two things, that nothing was removed, and that the death was an accident. If you want to spend a point here, any of you, you can get some further details.
I asked the question, so I will spin the point.
Sure. So how do you want to frame really that? Using your human intelligence, how do you want to get those that information out of him spending that point?
Oh, just like I said, in just that tone, that this man was not authorized. Who was his chain of command? Tell me now.
He shakes his head and he stares at the map on the table in front of him, and he doesn't even make eye contact you when you ask that, David Nelson. And he goes, listen, I was ordered by my superiors to keep quiet. I was told to say there's nothing removed, and revealing that that boy shot himself would be a disgrace to the Corps. And it possibly endanger his wife or any survivors. All right?
We are so not interested in smearing that soldier's good name, sir, but I do need to know about the man who looked at this first.
Yeah. Like I said, some fellow, Mormon was his name, Air Force, came here looking for something. He was doing the same thing you guys were, investigating, poking around, asking questions regarding the boy, and pictures and photographs. He was here, and he took place in an interrogation of a VC that we had captured. Next thing I know, they're interrogating this fella. He's dead. And the Air Force guy takes off with the body of not just the VC, but also Corporal Paul Lewis.
Got my notebook out. I'm taking notes. I said, sir, we were vetted heavily to be here in this area and to have you as our escort. Who vetted this man?
Tell you what, does anybody want, who's inspired? Do you have inspiration, David Nelson?
I don't know. Where can I find inspiration?
Inspiration is... I'm learning the character sheets here as well with you. Inspiration is under interpersonal.
Right under the human intelligence.
No, I have no inspiration. I am not an inspiring fellow.
Does anybody want to step in and use some inspiration? And spend a point of inspiration to maybe get something out of... Captain Rickard regarding what David Nelson, the trail David Nelson's going down.
I don't have inspiration, but I'll step in as an army guy. I'm like, sir, why would the flyboy be up in here with us grunts trying to make us look bad? We need to find this. If there's something bad going on, we can at least pin it on the flyboys and preserve the honor of our divisions.
I'll tell you what, that makes sense. You have, how many points in agency do you have? Because you're army also, right? Or ex-army?
As far as I know, it doesn't list
agency is under interpersonal. I think, who are you? You're Bobby?
I've got two on agency.
If you want to spend two, I will give you.
No, it's also listing I've got two under agency on two blank lines.
Yeah. I don't know what those two blank lines are. Everybody's is like that, and I don't understand why they're all like that. Would you like to... I'll tell you what. You leverage your agency. Do you want to spend 1 point or two? If you spend one, you'll get something. If you spend two, you'll get a little bit more.
Yeah, it's a one-shot. Let's spend two.
All right, he winks. And as he's winking, he goes, you're out of Kirtland Air Force Base, right? You know what he's doing. And that triggers with you guys. You know that Kirtland Air Force Base is a major, major, major majestic operational site. Your rival organization that you were out to stop, who's using it, wants to weaponize these things. Yeah. So he just winks and says that at you.
Understood. Thank you, sir. We've got Mystic to deal with. The Mystic's what they're called?
Majestic.
Majestic.
Sorry. Is the organization.
Majestic. I turned to the other guys and I'm like, it's Majestic's got it. They got here before us.
He says, hey, you're free to poke around. The rest of the squad is here. There's Corporal Paul Lewis. Well, he was the photographer. He's deceased, that poor boy. You can check the remnants of his tent. It's here. It's burned. Shot himself and burned his tent along with the photos, but you're free to go pick around it. He reported to Sergeant Porter Jackson. He was the squad leader. There's Specialist DeSilvo, the sapper, and Specialist Wemmer, the radio operator. Raleigh, who was their interrogator, who was there when that fellow shot our captured VC. And Dr. Smith, the medic for the squad. They're all here. You're free to go ask them any questions you will. But like I said, that fellow was here a couple days before you, and I'm pretty sure he got everything there was out of him.
Was there a transcript of that interrogation, sir?
There was, and that Mormon fellow took it with him. All traces of that interrogation, the transcript, photographs, anything and everything were taken by that fellow.
So I have a bond of your old squad mates. I'm not sure how bonds work in this, but can I use that? Is there a possibility that any of these guys are old squad mates of mine?
So the way bonds work, when you start to lose stability and sanity, more stability, you can pull on your bonds to bring you back as you start to go to the brink of insanity or become unstable.
Okay.
So you start to burn that bond. So like when you go back to the States and you go to reconnect with your old squad mates, if this were an ongoing game, we'd play that out when you go back, like how you come back and you're a little weird now and you're kind of distant to them because you've burned some of that bond and it's not quite there anymore where it once was. So those are like your anchors, your ties to keep you, try and keep you sane.
Gotcha.
That's why you can pull on the tie of your mother. I think Dr. Vanikar, that's yours. And some people have families and things like that. And you can, you come back and you're a changed man. You're different. You're not quite the same. And your family notices that sort of thing. And you start to burn that bond.
Do we have an idea where our, competitor here went to after this base? Was it one of this guy's choppers that he took, or
he went to the radio room, called something in. I don't know. As far as I know, he went back to the Air Force Base in Da Nang. I don't know. Took off in a hurry after he shot that VC.
Was there was nobody else in the interrogation room with him?
Yeah, Raleigh was present, the interrogator. He was there for part of it.
They leave.
What's that?
When did he leave?
Who, the Air Force?
Yeah, the Air Force man.
He left a day ahead of you.
Oak, you're our PsyOps guy, right?
Yup.
What do you think? Feel like interrogating an interrogator?
That's why I got some cocktails before we left.
Oh. We'd like to have a sit down with your interrogator here.
Yeah. Like I said, Raleigh. He's over in the tent. Just head straight out. Go in his tent. He should be in there. It's still a little bit of a mess in there. Like I said, after that fellow shot the prisoner after interrogating him. So if you don't mind the mess.
How many people have been in and out of that location since the interrogation, sir?
Myself. I've been in there and I've ordered others to stay out.
Only yourself, sir?
Myself. Well, and Raleigh himself, the interrogator.
I pull some stuff out of my kit, say, would you please put your finger here on this pad, sir, and roll it across this paper? I need to be able to discount your own prints in that room.
Yeah. So you want to just kind of convince him of this?
That convincing is a nice way of saying that.
I'm just looking at your skills. Your
I tell you what, I think I would use reassurance as I'm saying I'm trying to remove your prints from the scene because obviously you're not associated with it, but I got to be able to subtract out the prints, sir. So if you wouldn't mind giving me an imprintation here, we'll just rule you out of the scene.
Sure. He reluctantly, he rolls up his sleeve a little bit and what branch, what unit are you fellows with again? And he holds out his hand and prepares for to take his prints.
I'm afraid that's a need to know, sir. Yeah, and I give him the kind of like, you know, it's really out of my hands kind of look, but it goes very high up.
Sure. I'd, you know.
And you're sure there's no one else that would have been in there? I'll need to rule them out too.
Just that Air Force fellow who took off and Raleigh, the interrogator.
Did he happen to the Air Force fellow? Did he happen to sign any paperwork while he was in here?
No, he didn't. No, he didn't. I think he just poked around. Like I said, he took the recordings of the interrogation. He took the photographs. That's all I know.
Oh, very good. Yep, yeah, middle finger here too, and one more right here. Thank you, sir.
Right, yeah. Okay, yeah, it's straight down here outside my tent. Hang a left, and you'll find the interrogation tent.
We'll need to make this fast because he's already got a day ahead of us. We may need to catch up.
Go.
So you guys head out on the out of the tent, and you follow his directions to the tent where he says the interrogator is. As you're walking there, you pass a group of three guys sitting around playing cards, laughing and gambling and betting. Three young men. You head over to the interrogator's tent.
Yeah, I think I'm a little confused. Did the man kill himself on base here, or was it off base?
He did. Oh, no, okay. He killed himself here.
And do we know, have we gotten information as to which barracks or which tent he was in?
Yeah, so he did mention that he shot himself in the head and he burned his tent, and he said you're free to go look at the remains.
Okay. Looking at where the interrogation took place, which are the closest tents to it? Like, are they close enough that someone could have overheard the interrogation?
The photography tent is very close to it. The one that is now burned to the ground, where Corporal Paul Lewis took his life.
All right, so that one's gone. But other than that, are there any other tents nearby that could have been within earshot of the interrogation?
No, it's a more removed from the others, just because of the nature of what goes on in there.
All right.
So you head on over to the interrogation tent, and you throw open the flap, and you're greeted by a young man. He looks like he's in his early 20s with short, they've all got crew cuts, short dark hair and thick black rimmed glasses. And can I help you, gentlemen?
On our way over there, I approach Oak. I can't remember what your character's name is.
Bobby Brent.
Bobby Brent. I approach Bobby and say, hey, I don't know much about interrogation, but if you need a tourniquet, let me know. I'll be here ready to help.
Thank you. And I hold up a little bottle, shake. I said, this should be everything we need.
While you guys interrogate the interrogator, I'm going to pull Prince from the scene, see if we can't maybe
sure
find out who our air boy was.
Sure. Yeah. You start pulling.
Yeah. So I do have forensics. So I'm just going to basically blanket the scene, pull Prince. Anything else that looks unusual while I'm at it. If it's worth a spend, I'll spend, but otherwise I'm just using the base.
Yeah, just using the base. You're looking around for prints and such while they engage specialist Raleigh Dell, aka Rolly, as they call him. How can I help you, fellas? What's going on? What can I do for you?
I need to have a little discussion about an airport officer that was here earlier.
Yeah, that son of a bitch shot our prisoner. What do you want to know?
Everything. What was he asking? What were the answers? I need to know everything that went down and why.
Yeah. We couldn't get much information out of that fella. He, what was that prisoner's name? Win Ka? He just babbled. He babbled on and on about, killing them and light and the light everywhere and something growing out of a cave. I don't know. He was talking gibberish. My cracker's down there in the tunnel or something. But that fellow, that Air Force fellow, what was his name? Mormon. Came in here, asked a bunch of questions in Vietnamese and didn't like the answers he was given about darkness and things growing out of the tunnel. And he shot him in the head and took the records and called in the chopper, and that was it.
Is there anything like an insight? I feel like he's being straight up with me.
Yeah. Like with the last one, you used human intelligence with that guy, or anything that you feel you can pull on. It doesn't have to just be any one given skill. If you think like, I don't know, consider whatever.
Example, I've also fits. Got one in interrogation. So yeah. As an interrogator, am I picking up any tells or anything that he may be not completely giving me the whole thing?
Yeah. So knowing the game and see, you know, tells from people on their face and all that, and you can tell he's being very truthful to you. When he speaks of that Brent Mormon fellow from the Air Force, he's got a sign of like disdain on his face, especially when he talks about shooting the prisoner in the head. When he's talking about what the prisoner was talking about with the tunnels and such, it looks like he's completely telling the truth. He's more than happy to sell out and rat out the Air Force fellow who shot the VC.
I turned when they're talking about the Air Force fellow and I said, help me out here to set the scene. Where did Mr. Mormon sit and where was the prisoner sitting?
Mr. Mormon is right here, and he goes over to the middle of the room and there's a chair there and there's kind of like blood that's been cleaned up as best as possible. There's some blood splatter here and there. He goes, the prisoner was here in this chair. And Mr. Mormon was standing right here, and he stands right in front of the chair.
At any time, can you remember if Mr. Mormon grabbed the back of the chair?
He thinks back. He might have. Why? Well, is that important?
Hold out your hands.
He holds out both of his hands.
I take his prints.
Cut his hands off.
Get the roller and you start taking his prints. Yeah.
Yep. And I do the same to the back of the chair.
Sure. Yeah, you start taking prints off the chair. This room's been pretty well cleaned after the execution, essentially, that has taken place in here. So you're not having much luck pulling prints in this room as you would have hoped. Just because they've done their best to try and clean up the blood splatter from shooting the prisoner.
I'm going to ask him, what did you hear about the incident that led up to this?
That led up to the shooting? All I know is we went in them tunnels three days ago now. We found something strange. It was like a lamp of some sorts. And we pulled it out of the wall. It was like stuck to the wall. We pulled this thing off almost like it was gum. And it let out this bright light. And old Lewis there, he took a bunch of pictures. And when he developed them. So we know he shot himself in the head.
No one but him has seen those photos, huh?
As far as I know.
You were in the tunnels yourself?
Yeah, we went down there. We swept the tunnels.
And this thing stuck to the wall was a lamp? A lantern?
Yeah, it was like an old lamp, something ancient, I don't know, that the locals made centuries ago.
Air Force boy took that too.
Yeah. He took that as well. It was like twisted, misshapen metal. I don't even know how to describe it.
Wait, hold on. Metal?
Yeah. It was a metal object. It has metal. It's twisted, almost like ore, but not ore. And like I said, it just let out this light. And you were down there, and through the cracks came almost like black snakes. I don't know. You know the effects of this damn war. This place.
I'm sure it was just getting to you. How many hours ago did they leave on Chopper?
Oh, he looks down at his watch. I'd say it was about 12 hours ago.
Do I know from where the base is? He's probably heading how far away? Like, are they still going to be in transit, or is it already too late to catch them, maybe?
I don't know. Go see Wemmer, the radio operator. He was in there. The two of them were, I don't know, there's some kind of argument. He kicked him out of there. He had Wemmer call in something, kicked him out of there. Next thing you know, they called in Captain. The Captain was in there. There was some arguing, and then there's a Huey here taking him away. Body of Lewis, the body of the VC, interrogation tapes, and the lamp itself.
Did you touch the lamp yourself?
No, I didn't touch that damn thing. Like I said, when I saw like snakes of light and shadow coming out of the walls, I just wanted to get the hell out of there.
Who actually pulled it from the wall?
Lewis pulled it from the wall, and then that's when he took all the photos.
All right. Anything else you can tell us about this Air Force guy?
No. It's just a son of a bitch. They're shooting a prisoner. There's rules to war. As crazy as it sounds, there's rules of engagement. You don't do that. You don't just shoot a prisoner.
Where's the bodies now?
The bodies? He took them. That Air Force puke took them with him.
Do you speak Vietnamese?
I do.
What was the last thing, the last question that he asked him before he shot him? What did the guy answer?
He kept asking, what was in the tunnels? What was in the tunnels? And that fella, it was crackers. He just kept saying that there was light everywhere and things growing out of the walls. And he didn't like that answer. He shot him.
Boys, unless you can think of anything else, this guy has quite a head start on us. We need to talk to the radio man, find out if we can find out the destination of that Huey. We picked him up.
That, and if he knows who the pilot was, because if it's one of the local men here, maybe we can get him to set it down, pretending there's some sort of mechanical problem.
Yeah.
Go talk to the radio man.
Yeah, so you guys head outside the tent. He directs you to the radio tent, and again, you pass that group of three soldiers sitting there playing cards, and as you're walking by, they go, hey, you another Air Force man here poking around? You guys got your details. There's nothing left to know.
No, Army here, and list off whatever division I'm in or whatever.
Right.
We're not one of the flyboys, but we want this. He's pulling some stuff that's not authorized and trying to make us look bad.
Since he stopped us, I'll ask him, what do you guys know about what went down out here?
We're part of the squad that went into those tunnels. It's not right. It's not right what happened to Lewis taking his life.
Why'd he take his life?
Damned if I know. That boy never showed any signs of insanity or instability or anything.
Who was his bunkmates?
He bunked with DeSilvo, Sapper.
And where is DeSilvo right now?
He's over latrine duty.
So what is it you guys saw down in these tunnels?
How'd he pull latrine duty?
Nah, damned if I know. It's his turn. Someone's got to do it. One of the guys starts to speak up about the tunnels, and another guy interjects, and you see that he's got the markings of the sergeant, or of a lieutenant, actually. And he goes, We saw nothing. There's nothing going on down there. The VCs, they're in there. We scared them away. They sure got out of there in a hell of a hurry. You'd think they'd want to defend it, but there's nothing else down there.
We already know you're supposed to say that there was nothing. We've been told such, and we've been briefed on such. We need to be honest with us.
When you say that, you see that there's like a look of grief on his face, and like guilt. And he hangs his head low, and he goes, "Listen, I let that boy get killed. All right, indirectly." That's the only thing. It's the only thing that matters. It's not right. It's not right that Lewis took his life.
That's not your fault, sir.
It was on my watch. It was my damn fault.
Did you order him to remove the item in question?
He just kind of sits there shaking his head.
Was he the only one who touched the item?
Then, a fellow with Sergeant Stripes kind of speaks up. He goes, "Nah, he was the only one touched. Listen, them VCs, they didn't hold that tunnel very hard. All right, we went in there, we did our duty, we scoped it out, pulled something strange out of there. We came back, and that boy's dead now. All right, just leave it alone. It's been investigated.
What happened to the bodies of the VC?
The VC? We scared them away." We showed up, we fired a couple rounds, and they took off.
So they all left. You didn't kill any of them?
No, they took off. Over on the other side of the line, the other side of the DMZ.
This is the radio guy we're talking to, correct?
No, this is the sergeant now. You're talking to the lieutenant and the sergeant of the squad. The lieutenant's the one who kind of trailed off and blames himself for Lewis killing himself, and he's just kind of sitting there with his head in his hands, and you're talking to the sergeant now. He's got Sergeant Stripes and markings on his jacket. Those tunnels, they were filled with dead VC. Everywhere. Killed all kinds of ways. I don't blame him for taking off. Would you want to stay there? It was full of your dead comrades?
They're already dead when you went down there.
Yeah, it was bizarre. It was damn bizarre. There's something growing in and around them like weeds. I don't know what the hell went on down there.
What was growing in and around them?
It looked like, you know, like branches, fiber. I don't know. I don't know that. Listen, we went down there. We scoped it out. We saw there was no VCs. And we got the hell out of there.
How long dead? Fresh corpses? Bones?
Varied.
So a mix.
Various states of decay. We found this glowing piece of metal in the tunnel, like a lamp. Took it out. We figured the VCs were coming back for it, so we got the hell back here. Lewis took photographs. And the rest of the intel hall, radio code books, everything. It's all gone. That fellow from the Air Force took it.
He
was
took
the recovered from the fire that could have he didn't get a hold of.
A fire, sorry.
The fire, what you said, burned in the photography tent, correct?
Yeah, he burned his tent down.
Is there
anything? Set his tent on fire before he shot himself? What of it?
Air Force guy didn't get, maybe?
Negatives. If you actually got the...
Well, you know, you can poke around. There's a small junk repair tent next to it. I don't know. He didn't take a peek in there. You could take a look over there and see if you can uncover anything that he missed. He was more focused on the tent itself. But I know Lewis used to stash things over there.
Let's go look at that, boys.
Guys, we need to figure out where our competitor might have gone to. If you have any idea where he might have left to after he left this base, that would be the most useful piece of information you could possibly give us.
He showed up, asked a lot of questions, pulled rank with Captain Rickard, took the lamp away with him back to HQ. I heard he went back to Da Nang. I don't know, you'd have to ask the radio operator. Go ask Rolly. Or not Rolly, Wemmer. That's Wemmer. I wasn't in there. I just heard a lot of shouting, and that fella pulled rank. Does anybody have military science or agency USMC, United States Military Corps?
I have agency, but it doesn't say which. And
yeah,
it's
blank on everybody's.
I've got it down three different times.
I have military science.
So with military science, I'll say this. You do know that the only way an Air Force REMF pulls rank on a Marine captain is to call someone on the radio and get them to call their superior.
All right.
So there's no way that this guy pulled rank on the captain here.
Does it have REMF listed there?
It does.
Funny.
Have
you heard the phrase?
I'll relay that information to the rest of the crew. He got somebody on the horn to pull rank. He can't pull rank himself. Let's go talk to this radio man.
Let's try and save a little time. You guys seem to be really good at the interpersonal things. I'm going to go check out this hut next to the burned out hut.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a we need to get on the trail of this guy.
Sure. So I'll go. Does anybody else want to go with Nelson to the junk and repair tent?
No, I'm going to talk to the radio guy.
Okay. We'll jump over to the tent and you start peeking around and you're kicking things around, you're pushing things around, and you find a camera.
All right. Just looking at the mechanics, is there film in it?
You pop up in the back. There's no film.
No, I do not open the back of the camera.
Yeah, you're moving around. You don't see film in it, but you do see that it does have Corporal Paul Lewis written on it.
All right. If it will help to make a spend in anything here, I do have notice. I do have forensics. Yeah, if any kind of spend here would unearth anything, I'm willing to spend.
Let's see here. You kick around the room and all that, and that's the only thing that really stands out is finding the camera that was overlooked by Mormon.
Okay, but you said there's no film in it?
There's no film in it, the film from what you can see.
Okay. Can I close off windows, et cetera, here to make it dark?
Yes.
All right. So I'll do that so that I don't expose anything if it is actually in the camera. And sure. Then pop open the camera and see if there is anything back there.
Sir, yeah, you pop it open and you don't see anything in there. But as you're kind of like holding it up and moving it around, you see through the eyepiece, it almost looks like there's like a scratch or something on the lens or itself.
I'll turn around and take a look at it.
Yeah, you look through the eyepiece and to get a closer look at it, it looks like it's a scratch or divot on the lens, but and it's this weird kind of like squiggly shape, but as you take the camera down and away, you still see it. And it glows and starts to stretch and grow, and it's like a glowing squiggle that you are now seeing on your through your own eyes after taking the camera away. I'm gonna get you to make me.
Check?
Yeah. I'm gonna get you to make me a stability check.
And when you go off on your own, that's when shit happens.
So you can.
Well, I'm with him. I mean, he's not completely alone. You're gonna show it to me as well.
I think I'm in the midst of it right now, so yeah, let's find out what the stability shows first.
He's dealing with it. So you've got stability. You've got a stability tracker on your character sheet. You have a stability of 8 now. It's once you start going to 0 and past 0, things start to happen. Like, bad things start to happen, negative effects. So you can make a stability check for me. If you want, you can pull on some of your bonds. You can undo some of your bonds to help with stability. I think it's 2 points gets you a -1 difficulty on the roll. So I know you have a bond of 3 for your, or 2 for your partner, your FBI partner. I know there's no values filled in on the other ones. I think that's a, I downloaded these off the site, and I think that's a mistake. So we'll say that they're 2s across the board for all of them.
All right. Well, yeah, I remember back when we were investigating the serial killer and had our first touch of the supernatural, some of the pointers that my companion told me when you see things like this and how to ground yourself so that it doesn't overwhelm you. And I think back to that, and I'll use that. And so, okay, what does that do for me?
So you're going to go ahead and roll a D6. It's going to lower the difficulty by 1. So I'll tell you right now, it won't be a secret. The difficulty is going to be a 4. You want to roll 4 or higher. And if you fail, you're going to lose 3 points of stability. If you pass, you don't lose any. So that'll move you further down the stability track.
So I rolled a 3, but I burned the 2 points. So does that do anything?
No. So it was initially a difficulty of 5. So it reduced it down to a 4. Okay. By doing that. So you lost, what was it, 3 points?
Mm-hmm.
Does that still burn the bond?
It does.
You
still burn.
I think you can actually spend stability as well, but you're also spending against what you would lose. But, you know, you could decide that it might be worth spending or burning 1 instead of losing 3, you know?
Yeah, so you can do that. So you can decrease the difficulty number, and you can also burn them and spend them to get stability back. You can use it in both ways. You're correct.
Yeah. Well, I've already made the roll, though, so I'm going to lose 3.
Yeah, you lose 3 stability, so go ahead and mark that on your character sheet. And there's examples here for when you lose, like, 1 to 2 points of stability, 3 to 4. So it says here, 3 to 4 points lost stability. You might have to stop a bit and hyperventilate, or you're blinking a lot, or maybe you're sweating. So what does this look like?
Yeah, so I'm pausing, and I'm blinking, and I'm shaking my head, kind of smacking the side of my head like I'm trying to get my eyes to focus again.
Right. Yeah, rubbing your eyes and such. And you still see this, like, it's like a squiggle, weird kind of distorted shape, and it's growing and glowing, and you're staring at this thing, and you're rubbing your eyes. And Dr. Vanikar, you're there with him, and you see him just, like, frantically rubbing his eyes and blinking and kind of hitting the side of his head, and...
Yeah, is there anything I can roll to see if I can help him out a bit? Maybe health?
First aid?
First aid? I didn't see that on there.
I think it's at the bottom of your general. I think I had to add it. Let me see. Vinikar. I know for sure you have first aid because you're a doctor. General abilities. You have 8 in first aid under general abilities.
I cannot see that, but yeah, I'm definitely going to spend, I think, 2 points to help him out.
And so what does that do?
I just want to see. Oh yeah, you've definitely got it on there. Far right hand side, halfway down, first aid, under general.
Ah, there we go. Okay, I see it. I was looking way down at the bottom of it.
Yeah, you can burn 2 points, roll me a d6. They rolled 3 times. Roll again and add your +2 onto it. We can't hear you. Your push to talk is not, you're not pushing to talk.
found if the Zoom window isn't in focus, it doesn't unmute.
Oh, that's weird. Okay. You can hear me now then.
Yes. Yep.
1 second. I'm just going to add the 2 points on.
And be sure to decrease your first aid skill by 2. You now have a 6 instead of 8 for available points.
Well, that took its sweet time to actually roll. There we go.
I don't see it. Do you guys see it?
Yeah, you got a 5. 3 oh. plus 2.
Oh. In the future, you can just press the macro, eh? You can just hit first aid.
Oh, okay.
And it pops up and asks you how many points you want to add on and everything.
Well, that'll be much easier.
So yeah, you go over, what does this look like? How are you comforting or trying to help?
I'm going to walk over and just do a quick check. I'm going to check his heart rate, check his vitals across the board, make sure he's okay, and see what might be wrong with him.
Sure, you pull out the first aid kit, and you pull out a little, there's a little flashlight, and you shine in his eyes. Hey, Chuck, thanks for the bits. Start putting the flashlights in his two eyes to see if there's like a scratch or what he's describing, and you don't see anything on his eye itself. But you do calm him down. You bring him down and you soothe him. Your bedside manner calms down.
Does that do anything system wise? Do I get stability back for that?
I'm going to give you 1 point of stability back based off of that.
Doc, yeah, it's the camera. There's no film in it, but it seems to have caught something anyway. It's on the lens, like burned into the lens.
Now, on a scale from 1 to 10 here, is this something I should try to not look at myself?
I don't think it's a good idea, Doc. Here, I'll kind of sketch out what I saw on a piece of notebook paper.
Hey, if I saved you one sanity, it was all worth it, right?
Yeah, heck yeah.
Stability. Let's jump over to the other two who've gone over to the radio operator to go see Specialist Wemmer. So you guys head over to the radio tent, and there's a young man there, short crop blonde hair. He's got a tattoo on his arm. He's got his sleeves are cut off. He's got a tattoo on his arm of a ace of spades. And you guys come in. He greets you. What's hello, fellas. What can I do for you? Need to radio something in?
Possibly. Well, you had somebody, an Air Force boy, come through here 12 hours ago or so. You called in a Huey for him?
Yeah. Mormon, that fellow from REMF.
Yep. Do you know who was flying? Who took him in? Is one from your unit here?
No. We called it back into Da Nang. He came in here, and he asked me to radio Kirtland Air Force Base for him. Then he shooed me out of here, ordered me out of the tent, pulled rank, and that's it. I don't know what the hell he talked about.
So Kirtland's the only people you got a hold of.
Yeah, Kirtland.
We heard there was some kind of argument between you guys. What was that about?
Do either of you have reassurance to try and pull some information out of him?
Reassurance? I do not.
Or a suitable skill to maybe get some gossip or information out of him.
I've got 2 reassurance I can burn.
Sure. You want to spend a point? 1 is enough. He goes, yeah. You heard about that? Mormon, he called, I stood outside the tent, and Mormon, he called Rickard to the tent, the captain, and, I peeked my head in. I was keeping an eye on what was going on, and Rickard listened to something on them headphones, and, He was none too pleased. He didn't like what he heard, and the next thing I know, Mormon's giving him orders. The VC prisoner gets shot. He takes the lamp, he takes Luce's body, he takes the notes, and he heads on back to Da Nang.
You know who's on the other end of that call?
Hey, all I know was I heard some sort of code. What was it now? It was, what'd he say? It was, Tangent Pluto? Like the dog, you know, Mickey Mouse? Tangent Pluto is what he said.
Does that mean anything to us?
Yeah, you know that as a call sign or an identifying code for Majestic.
Do you, the pilot who picked him up, do you happen to actually know him or know anybody that does know him?
The fellow that was flying the Huey?
Yeah.
I don't know. There's so many of them flyboys going in and out all over this. This is a war. It's a war, sir. There are Hueys everywhere. Well, I was hoping
maybe you knew him personally if you could get a hold of him to try to
no, set the
bird down.
I don't know him personally. I'm sorry, sir.
It was 12 hours ago. I think he's long gone. How long is it the flight back to?
Oh, it's just like an hour back, just south of here to Da Nang.
Okay. So yeah, he's already
probably. Yeah, there's birds all over the skies and flyboys everywhere. I don't know who it was.
Do we have a radio contact back when we get information?
Yeah, you guys can radio back. You've got a call sign. They know that who you are, that you're with.
So I'm going to ask, hey, I need you to radio this in to this frequency or whatever. I'm not sure how that works.
Yeah, you want to radio back to the Air Force Base in Da Nang?
Yeah, to our contacts.
Sure. Yeah, are you going to shoo him out of the tent? Like,
do I feel I should? Or do I have any codes I can say to keep everything kind of under the radar?
Yeah, what do you want to say? What do you want to say on the radio? How about that?
Basically, I want to get a hold of whoever our contact is and let them know that... and what was the call sign that the other dude used? Tango Pluto?
Tangent Pluto.
And let them know Tangent Pluto has already arrived and absconded with our targets.
All right. You just get confirmed. Have you acquired the parcel?
Negative. Tangent Pluto absconded with everything.
Roger. Shall we arrange a pickup?
Unless there's something else we need to do here, yes.
All right.
Roger. We need to check out this tunnel, don't we, before we leave?
Bird's on its way.
We were just told to get the lamp, weren't we? Been there, right, Matt? We were just told to get the lamp.
Yeah, you were told to get information in the lamp, if possible. To get it, destroy it, bring it back, whatever you deem... to be the right course of action.
How far away? Now it's going to take them about an hour or so to get here.
Yeah, they say they'll be a bird there in roughly 20 minutes. They'll reroute someone.
Okay. Now how far away?
You guys are kind of a priority as secret agents running around the DMZ.
How far away are the tunnels?
The tunnels are by helicopter. You guys, this guy says, about by helicopter, you take a Huey. They're about, 20 minutes north of here.
Well, if we want to check that out, we can have our pilot take us. Go check, see what the other guys found. Thanks for your time.
Through the jungle.
Yeah, I don't know if those other fellas told you what was in there, but there was bodies and all kinds of things. I don't know if you fellas want to go there.
Yeah, did you go yourself? What was it?
Yeah, I was with the squad there. I saw the same things those boys did. We pulled that thing off the wall. There was like tubes of light and darkness coming out, and bodies lying the. I've never seen anything like this. Bodies lying the walls and states of decay. I don't blame them VCs for taking off.
I don't know. What do you think? You want to check out the tunnels? Bobby?
Bobby's daughter's...
Yeah, sorry, I'm being jacked with. What's up? Sorry, what did you say?
All right, you want to go check out these tunnels? Are we going to just head out after this
after this let's guy. Let's see what everybody else found out in that other tent and what they think we should do.
Yeah. Do you guys are you guys we good with
before checking it out?
Are you good with the information? Are you done with the radio man?
Yeah.
Hey, Matt. Things.
Yeah.
Matt. So as I'm not sure I'm fully understanding Delta Green. I know we investigate. Are we supposed to like shut it down? Like
yeah, your orders
hide it from the public, like Men in Black type of thing?
Yeah, so hide it from the public. But you've been given the orders to either destroy it, bring it back, whatever you deem the right course of action. Knowing now that Majestic is involved, you definitely want to get it out of their hands because they want to weaponize it. And you are the opposite. You feel like this should not be tampered with by mankind, and it's better off destroyed or out of their hands.
Guys, if we're going to the tunnel, should we bring along something to help us collapse it as part of the cover-up?
Yeah, we should, but I don't think we have time. I think we have to go after this agent. If it sounds like that's our number one priority.
Well, he said if it's only an hour to Denang, then he's got an 11 hours head start from that point. So they've probably got on a jet or something, and they're out of country.
All right, then let's go to the tunnels and blow them.
Have you met back with the rest of us yet?
Yeah, do you guys want to, if you wandered
yeah,
back
yeah.
now?
Yeah, we'll go back to the other two.
All right, in which case, guys, does this symbol mean anything to any of you? I've sketched it out on a piece of paper and just kind of handing it around.
Have I ever seen anything that looks like that or heard about it during
this time? I'm going to say no. No, you've not seen anything like that. It's it's a weird squiggle sort of shape.
Tentacle.
Not a tentacle. It's like a... there's a shape to it. But you can't really make out what it is. It's like an outline of light that he's seen.
I'll explain that I found his camera, and the camera seems to have captured the image of whatever he was looking at. It's on the lens itself. I would not look through it yourself. It had a very bad effect. I kind of look at my watch and I make a note of the time on the notepad. I'm gonna start writing down if I start feeling odd. Just so you all know, I was exposed to something.
Is it possible to get
this is a sketch of
the
squiggle right here.
So we're being picked up in an hour?
About 20 minutes.
20 minutes.
So there's no time to get over to the thing at all then?
Oh, so we could
the
get
tunnel, our... The tunnel's by chopper. We don't want to trek through the jungle. He said it was a...
Is it possible for our chopper that's taking us back to the capital to pick us up from the tunnels?
I figured they'd take us there.
Yeah. Chopper will take us to the tunnels first.
I mean, there's a doodle of what this shape he saw.
Where's the doodle?
On the map of...
On the map.
Vietnam. Right by Denang.
Delaware. Right.
Delaware. It's shaped like Delaware for those of you listening to us on the stream.
Yeah.
Now the true horror is known.
Great.
There you go. So that's what his drawing looks like.
Well, let's make it to the tunnels. We'll get choppered out of the tunnels right back to the capital. And while the chopper's there, he'll have a payload that should be able to deal with collapsing it for us.
Before the chopper comes, is there anyone here that we still need to talk to that we haven't spoke with yet?
You haven't spoken to De Silvo, his bunkmate.
Yeah, we need to do that to see if he was raving right before he killed himself.
Let's go talk to De Silvo real quick before the chopper gets here.
If we can get some stuff where we go, I've got 3 in demolitions also.
Yeah, pick up some explosives.
Yeah, and I have
attaboy.
Yeah, there's definitely explosives here. You can requisition those from the captain. That's fine.
I have 6 in demolitions.
Nice.
So you go and you track down and you ask around for De Silvo and you find this young man, a young Italian-American guy. sitting around, and he's in his tent on his bunk, and yeah, what can I do for you?
So we hear your roommate shot himself after he looked at whatever was in, after he developed his film from the tunnels. We want to know what's going on.
Yeah. Lewis, we went in those damn tunnels, and
you didn't go yourself?
No, I was there. Right. He goes on to describe the tunnels. He gives the layout. He explains how it looks like they were pre-existing. They led into a pre-existing cavern, but the tunnels themselves are, looks like they're recently dug. And there was there was like shaped stone tools lying on the ground. He's like, oh, it's weird. It's an old place. It's an old place. I don't know what those VCs uncovered.
But so they were digging up digging into the tunnel from what you could tell.
Yeah. It looks like they uncovered something old. And that metal thing, that glowing metal thing that we found, that was in a different section of the tunnels. It was further back. It was deep in there. But you know, I say metal, but it's more like metal rich ore, but not even that either. It was weird. It's bizarre. I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen metal like that. Does anybody have archaeology?
I do.
All right. You don't even need to spend
a
point.
No, it's anthropology. Wait.
No.
I thought I saw it. Hold on.
Archaeology would be under academic.
Anthropology. I summoned my ancestor, John Merrick.
Yeah, right?
I do not have archaeology.
Oh, okay. Yeah, nobody has archaeology. That's fine. Yeah. He goes, I was the one that found Luce's body in the tent.
Yeah, and it was
horrible.
What was it? What was he? Did you you hear him shoot himself?
Well,
what was he ranting and raving about?
First the tent went up in flames, and then we heard the shot. And by the time we put out the flames, you know, I found his body, and I found his tags, and confirmed it was Lewis.
Did anyone figure out what started the fire?
Gasoline or something. Dump something, and there's some sort of accelerant.
We need to check out the remains of that tent, I think, guys. All right, anything useful you can tell us?
No. He shot him. He took his own life, Lewis. It's not right.
Well, how was he acting right up to that? How was he the night before?
He was fine. He was fine. He was normal. He was his normal self. That's why this is so bizarre.
Did he talk about seeing anything odd or repeating certain phrases or anything?
No. He's acting like his normal self.
Even before he killed himself?
Even before he killed himself. He was not acting strange at all. He said he was going to go off, develop the photos he took in that damn tunnel, and next thing you know, the tent's on fire, and he's taking his own life.
All right, thanks. Yeah. I'm going to...
You fellas with the REMF as well?
Not exactly.
Sure.
All right, well, one of you were already poking around. What's that?
It's not an organization. That's a derogatory term for guys who don't do combat.
There you
that's
go.
That's rare echelon motherfuckers is what that stands for.
There you go. That's how they all refer to the Air Force guy.
All right, I want to go check out the tent that's burnt. Just poke around a little bit. See if we can find anything.
If anybody has criminology or demolitions, you can spend a point poking around there.
I do have criminology.
Yeah, you want to burn a point?
Sure.
Criminology? You poke around, and yeah, the story, DeSilvo's story is backed up. This was no accident. You find some, what looks like a canister, a metal canister of what had gasoline in it from one of the vehicles, and as used as an accelerant, and just kind of retracing this fire and how it started. It looks like he dumped it where the photos were being developed, and on the spot around there, and you can see a really heavy burn mark where he must have been standing, and he must have been doused in gasoline as well, and this was no accident. And it looks like it all focuses and centers in on where he was developing the photos.
Anything around the, anything survived the fire, poking around the ashes?
No, the other thing you notice, and the other group confirmed this, that there was no remains of a camera at all. Which all David right. Nelson has already found and looked through and lost a little bit of his stability.
I think we're done here then, aren't we, guys? Anything else?
I think that about covers it.
I think I hear the chopper blades.
That's right. You hear the Huey landing. Coming in. So, you got your Huey there, and pilot's like, we're going back to Da Nang?
We've got a slight detour.
Yeah. Do we grab some C4 and whatever else we can find? I'd like to grab a rifle too.
Sure, like what, an M16?
Yeah.
Standard issue.
In this now's war? The time to get those grenades you're asking about.
I'm gonna get a rifle also.
Yeah. Yeah, so you go to Captain Rickard and you want to requisition some heavy artillery and some explosives. Go ahead. Who wants to try and requisition that? Do you want to pull a bureaucracy? Someone else spend some points of bureaucracy and make a roll and
plead
a case on why you want some explosives and some...
I've got 7 points to burn, so I can probably cover us.
Sure. All right.
So you hit your bureaucracy button there, or the word bureaucracy. And it'll ask you how many points you're spending. And
how many do I need to spend to get everybody the stuff they need?
So a success is 4. So you just need to get a 4 higher. And you're rolling a D6. So how many points do you want to spend to make this happen?
I'll just spend 3 and not worry about a roll, because it'll be automatic then.
Yeah, you're not wrong. Roll for fun, just to see what happens.
Might get extra.
I guess you guys are getting like lights and such to go down to this tunnel, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, just a bunch of combat gear, weapons, ammo, grenades.
Do you want
And we're gearing up for some spelunking.
Do you want to tell him where you're going? Oh yeah, look at that. Hell yeah, you rolled a 6. There you go. Yeah. Yeah, you fellas can go ahead. Take what you need.
All right, we stock up.
Off we go.
All right, so you guys head into the chopper and you give the order to head north to the tunnels themselves. It takes you deeper.
Yep.
You head now towards the DMZ. You're getting deeper and deeper to the front lines. There's not much going on here. There's a lot less signs of active combat. You do see that there's like bombed out areas that have been hit by B-52s and such. And it almost looks like craters on the moon, the ground around there. And you guys follow the directions and you get to the tunnel. And the Huey comes down and drops you off. He says, "Hey, I can't stick around here, fellas. I'm too close to the front lines."
We're not going to be here long.
30 all right.
minutes. I'll give you. We're shutting something down here, then we're leaving.
I'll give you 10 minutes, and then I'm out of here. So you guys land, and you see there's like 3 orange flags fluttering from the wind of the blades metal spikes marking the entrances that the Marines found. That you do see that there's three entrances leading into the like these actual tunnels themselves. The tunnels are pitch black, and it looks like those are the only way in. They're narrow. They're only like 2 to 3 feet wide and low, so you're gonna have to get down and crawl to get into these things.
Well, we picked up some spelunking gear, right? So
yeah,
lights on. Let's go.
Yeah, yeah. So you get down.
Yeah, I've been in these tunnels before, not these tunnels, but I've had to crawl through.
You
tunnels.
Are familiar with, yeah, the Viet Cong tunnels. Yeah, yeah, you've seen them. Yeah, you've spent time fighting in this war, so you're definitely familiar with these. So you get down on your bellies and you start wiggling your way through. Are you guys all going to go into the same tunnel? Do you want to each take... there's three tunnels in total. Do you want to take different tunnels? Do you want to split up? What do you want to do?
Actually, take a look at the tunnels, because if our troops just came out of there, they would have left a mess. So look for boot prints, etc.
Sure, yeah, it was a few days ago. You're poking around.
With whoever's got demolition skills, I know at least two of us do, probably separate tunnels so we can set charges.
I have a two in it, I believe, as well.
Sounds good. All right, I'll go down the left tunnel.
Yeah, the most activity in... and the footprints you see is down what looks to be a... it was built as a drainage tunnel. That looks to have the most activity around it.
Yeah, they would have come out here. So this is probably where they found that metal object. So one of you guys with a demolition pack, here, I'll double up with one of you. We'll go down this path.
Nick, you should probably do that one since you have the highest demo skill.
All right.
I have a two in demolition, so I'll go to the third tunnel and set up there, I guess. I'll be spending both of my points here, so that'll be the end of that.
Yeah, I'll spend all three of mine and make sure this thing's shut down.
Yeah, I'm going to crawl in a little ways first, though, and see what I can find inside.
Sure. So you're crawling. Are you guys all crawling in, or are you just playing explosives? Other than Stan.
A little ways to make sure we can set them where they're deep into to cave everything in.
Yes. All right. So you start wiggling your way in and crawling in about halfway. And your lantern or your light that you have, I don't know, a flashlight on your shoulder or whatever, it's shining down. And you can see as you're about halfway down and starting to set up your explosives, it looks like it enters into a bigger room, a bigger cavern. And you can actually see the flashlights from other tunnels also hitting that cavern. So it looks like... you can only assume that the other tunnels all lead into this one central cavern.
All right. What can we see looking around the cavern? Take my flashlight out and shine around.
You can see, shadows around the walls and stuff, huddled around the walls.
The cavern floor is even with where we're crawling, or there's a drop?
It's even.
All right, how big is this cavern?
It looks really big.
We can stand?
As you're sitting, yeah, it looks like you'll be able to stand. As you're sitting in your tunnels, though, you get your nostrils are hit with a terrible smell. Like a horrible smell. Who's seen military? You've all seen military. Yeah, it's a smell of death is pouring out of there. You guys all have military backgrounds, don't you?
I mean, I'm a surgeon. I assume I know what a cadaver smells like.
Yeah, it's the smell of death pouring out of there. I'm actually going to get you guys all to make a unnatural stability check. So go ahead and make me a stability check.
How do we do that in the sheet?
Stability or what?
It's going to be stability. So it's a D6. You just roll a D6. And if you want to, you can burn bonds. And I forgot this on Bertzel, so I apologize. You can burn bonds to help you make stability checks, or you can also burn points of stability. So, like, you have points in stability. You can spend points in stability to give you pluses on your roll to not fail that roll.
I'm always willing to risk some insanity.
Yeah, I'm going to spend one.
One point of stability and add it to your...
Yeah. I'm glad I did.
You're good. You're good. Dr. Vanikar, you know, you are a medic. You are familiar with the smell. It doesn't bother you. But Stan and Bobby are assaulted by the stench of death. And Stan, that takes you back. That takes you back to your tour of duty here in Nam. And, you know, you start to have a little bit of a flashback and maybe you get a little bit of a tremble. As you're lying there in a VC tunnel, Doug tunnel, as you're bombarded with the smell of death all around you. So you lose 2 points of stability, Stan, and as do you, Bobby.
That would take me to -1. What does that do for me?
-1. No, oh, no, boy. No. No, you're 2 points. Let me find your character sheet here. You are Stan Madison. You have 7 stability. I don't know why it's grayed out on your character sheets. You have 7.
Oh, okay.
So take you down to 5. And again, that's a minor stability. So like they describe it as like a tremble or something like that. Like a little tell. A twitch, a stutter. Your voice raises a bit. So it's not much, but there is like a noticeable like tell. So who knows? Maybe you're twitching and you're...
Yeah, I'm sweating. I'm fidgety.
When we get out of here, I'm going to give everybody some smelling salts to help get their feet back under them.
You can give them all acid.
I can help with that.
I'll go ahead and stand up in the cavern, though. And
yeah. So you're shining a light around the cavern, and there's piles of dead and rotting bodies, like, everywhere. We're going to have to make another stability check here. If you're actually in there viewing this.
Yeah,
I think we might all be here in a second.
Stan, this is a violence stability check. You're adapted to violence, Stan. So this is actually going to be easier for you than it is everybody else because you have those 3 points of stability. Right. For you, this is only going to be a difficulty of 1. Everyone else, it's a difficulty 3 stability. I think he's the only one who has points in violence.
All right. I've seen this is pretty bad, but I've seen worse.
Yeah. So you guys are all holding it together. Ones who've crawled further in there. And yeah, there's piles of dead, rotting bodies everywhere. Do you want to take a look? Does anybody have forensics? Take a closer look to see what killed them or what?
Yeah, I have forensics.
All right, you want to spend a point of forensics to ascertain what happened here?
Yeah, it's my only point, but I'll spend it.
Okay. You start poking around, you're looking at the bodies, and it looks like they killed each other and themselves. Some of them bit or tore each other's eyes out. Bodies are riddled post-mortem with M16 fire. You're assuming came from the Marines that were down here. Does anybody have military science?
Oh, wait a minute.
Hold on a second.
Hold on a second. If there are riddled with bullet fire, then those army guys lied to us. Because they said they didn't fire upon anyone.
They said they shot a couple times.
But not kill. I specifically asked if they killed any of the VC. They said no.
Yeah, well, forensics show that they were shot post-mortem.
Post-mortem.
That means they were already dead, so if they just fired off, they may have hit dead bodies and not known it.
Does anybody want to spend a point in military science?
Sure.
Yeah, I'll spend one. Or somebody.
It looks like the bodies were moving when they were encountered.
Looks like they were moving when what?
They were encountered. So they're shot post-mortem, and they were moving.
All right. Blow the place. Let's go.
As you're looking around the place with the forensics, David, you see what looks like light glittering in their eyes of the corpses, almost like polished metal. Only David Nelson sees this.
Can I use my sense trouble to...
I don't think you have to.
Yeah, you don't have to spend anything here. This does not seem right. Between the forensics check and the military science, I don't know if David Nelson's telling you what he sees, but he's seeing glowing polished metal in the eyes of some of the corpses, glowing to him right now. He's the only one who looked at the camera, right? Yeah.
Yeah, let's blow this and get out of here.
Let's get out of here.
We got motion down there, guys. Let's blow this place.
I start placing C4.
Yeah, I'm on the other side of the cavern doing the same thing. So
You're gonna start wiring this whole cavern and scurry out of there and wire it and you get out there. The Huey is still sitting there and he's starting to gear up his blades to get out. Like you said, you've got 10 minutes. And did you just want to blow this thing up?
If we have a timer or something on it, we can set so we can get in the air first.
Let's use somebody has demolitions. I'm thinking it's
I've got Stan. Yeah, we all have demolitions, or several of us do.
You've got the best one though, Nick.
I think Stan has the highest, I think. So Stan, you can go ahead and you can make me the demolitions roll. You're the one who's rigging this up.
All right.
Do you want to spend points on this and make sure that this goes off without a hitch?
Oh, yeah.
You got 6 points.
Oh, yeah.
So go ahead and hit your demolitions button and tell it how many points of your 6 you want to spend to blow up this cavern full of post-mortem moving
the gear?
Bullet-riddled bodies.
I hit the gear?
No, not the gear. The gear will actually have you... edit it. Just hit the word demolitions.
On the word?
Yeah.
That's not doing anything either.
Are all three of us rolling demolitions or just the one?
No, just Stan. Let me just take a look at his character sheet here.
Spend all the points.
Oh.
Spend all the points.
Here, let me click that. Oh, there you go. Oh, Vankman. Vankman, you're not. Yeah. Okay. I don't know why the gears are on there. I got to make the gears go away.
I was just curious to see if I would.
And now you should be able to push demolitions if you hit that. Oh, yeah, now it'll work. It's because the gears were up.
Oh, it's under my character sheet window. All right, I'll spend. I'm going to spend. Is this a normal success? Do I know?
Yeah, it's a normal success. You just need four or more.
All right, I'll spend 3 then.
All right, so you rig this thing and you time it. You're obviously, this was a specialty of yours when you were serving in the army. Yeah, you can tell the others to, you know, stand back. You got this sort of thing.
Yeah. I just helped the doctors helped me wire things up, and we set it to blow, and then stand back, fellas.
Yeah, you want to get in the Huey and start taking off and watch this thing light up from the sky. You set it up.
Yeah,
that way.
That sounds good.
All right, you tell the flyboys to take off, and he gets up in the sky, and as he starts to bank and pull away, just a boom rattles out, and you see fire shoot up through the tunnels, and the rocks kind of collapse in and around itself, and like dust and everything kind of pick up into the sky and up into the air, where this cavern and tunnels once were. You tell the flyboy to head on back to Da Nang.
Zombie land is dealt with.
All right.
Yeah, but the guys at Majestic have the lamp. I think the lamp is what is giving those things life.
Yeah, we that's kind of next. That's what we have to deal with, I think.
When you get back to the Air Force Base at Da Nang. Yeah, so you guys fly back and you get back to Da Nang. It's I'm gonna say it's late night now. It's about 11 p.m. You've spent a whole day at Firebase Jonas, asking around, asking questions, getting to the tunnels, blowing the tunnels up. And you get back, it's late at night. You guys land the same area where you took off previously. It's night now. There's a military police cruising around in jeeps, the base and the area. You see them stationed all about. Whereas you didn't really see as much of a presence of MPs when you were here previously. And this is a big base. This is a very large base. This is where operations are launched for the front lines. So there's hangars and warehouses and storage areas and offices and barracks. There's all sorts of things here at this Air Force base. What do you want to do? You are now back at the Da Nang Air Force Base.
I'm assuming we're going to have to report in to whoever we answer to.
Right. It was Carlson, Agent Carlson. Do you want to bother her at this time of night, or?
Yes.
Is it protocol?
Sure, sure. So you arrange to have her called. She gets on the radio and she's so what is the status of the mission?
Well, we're going after Agent Mormon of the Majestic program. We have in our possession not the artifact, but something that was touched by the artifact. It itself has exhibiting some properties now.
All right, affirmative. So we're dealing with Majestic here. What was the name of the agent?
He gave his clearance as Air Force. What do you say, Air Force? What was the Frank?
I think he was a lieutenant. I can't remember what he.
Yeah, his name was M something. I can't even
Brent
remember.
Mormon. Yeah, it was Mormon. So Lieutenant Mormon.
That name's come up a lot in the area. He's a very active agent of Majestic. He's been on quite a few operations here.
There's also an area of contamination with possible reanimated that has been neutralized.
Good job, agents. Good work.
This Majestic agent has the lantern.
Right, and where did he head with the lantern when he left Firebase Jonas?
Parcel, I believe, is what they over the radio. It's parcel.
Where did he end up with the parcel?
We followed him back to Danang, right?
Yeah. We don't know where he went from here, but he's got, a 48-hour lead on us?
And what did he have? He just had the artifact, the parcel itself?
Photographs and transcriptions.
Took a body too.
Two bodies. She goes,
he's only got maybe a 13-14 hour lead on us.
She goes, two bodies, a parcel, and information. I recommend that you search this Air Force base for any information or signs of where he may have headed next. That is not something that you can move around easily with here. People will question you if you have two bodies.
Probably still around here then.
Do you have any info about how Majestic has been operating in this area that might give us a good place to start?
Negative. I've not been made privy to their operations here. I just know that name Mormon has come up more than once recently. He's been quite active. He's been very active, starting with he was in Korea as one of their main agents. And he's made his way over here now.
We're going to have to pull rank with people in the base here to get the information we need. Can we tap you to do that?
Let me see what I can do. In the meantime, I suggest you start asking around.
I was in Korea. Does Mormon mean anything to me?
No, you don't recognize the name.
I'm assuming there were more than 10 people in Korea, so
yeah, yes, there was more people fighting in the Korean War than 10.
And it's probably an alias anyway.
Yeah, at least 12.
Some of them might even be Koreans, which I probably don't speak the language.
So she says she will be in contact with you as soon as she has further details. So you guys are left standing near the runways, and near the runways there's long lines of like cargo warehouses, which hold military equipment, personal effects, yes, even bodies waiting to be shipped back to the states of dead soldiers.
What do you think, guys? Do we requisition a list of potential corpses that are being arranged to travel out, or do we consult a morgue, or how do you want to go about?
Let's check with the what would you call it? Like the flight officer or whoever.
We're going to probably the radio officer too, because he's going to have called to requisition anything he needed, flights out and or disposition of the bodies.
I'll tell you what, Sten, you, it says any agent with a Vietnam experience or army, Sten, this is you. You know, this is a 0 point spend for you. You know, if you want to try and get some information on Mormon, you need to go to the bachelor's officer quarters. Transient officer billeting and the mayor's cell in the administrative offices is where you're going to find information. That's where all the comings and goings are. Paperwork still needs to be filed, whether it's legit or not. Names need to be dropped and people are coming and going through here. And those are the places where you're going to find them the easiest.
The bachelor's mess hall?
Bachelor's officer quarters, the transient officer billeting, and the mayor's cell. And it's all in the administrative offices block.
All right. I'll pass that information on to everybody. This is where we need to go.
Normally, this Air Force base is like a hive of activity. But right now, with it being nighttime, it's mostly MPs patrolling and cruising around.
All right. I'll lead the way. Let's go to the... let's go to the mayor's.
The mayor's cell, as it's called.
Mayor's cell.
It's in quotes. It's slang, I'm assuming. For the administrative offices. Yeah, you head on over, and yeah, you're passed by, as you're walking over there, a Jeep pulls up with a couple of military police, and they ask for your identifications and what you're doing there, what your business is, and ask, where are you heading, fellas? It's pretty late. What are you doing out here? Shouldn't you be in the barracks?
It is late. Could you guys go get us a couple cups of coffee?
No.
or better yet, give us a ride.
Yeah, they kind of glare at you, Doc. Just like, who's this asshole? Say to get in the back. They let you hop in the back of the Jeep. Ordering military police around.
Yeah, we're headed to the mayor's cell.
We didn't travel all this way to play games, right?
We're throwing you in the break for the night. All right, are you taking to the barracks?
Yeah. Or let's go to the barracks first. Barracks, guys, I'm also...
the mayor's office.
You're asking the military police to take you there?
To the mayor's cell?
The mayor's office? Yeah, mayor's cell?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right, they go, what's your business there this time of night?
Need to know.
That's classified.
Well, we need to know. It's need to know information, and we need to know. We're at war here, gentlemen, and you're just wandering around a base in the middle of the night.
There, and we will have you tell, we will have them tell you that our business is classified.
Well, how about we take you in for questioning?
We know if our handler, if we call in, that they can pull rank.
We've already asked her to do that.
Would you like to
we've already asked
bureaucracy here to try and you're just ordering these military police around.
I guess 7 points of bureaucracy it's been.
Sure. So what do you want to say to them as the doc there is just like, hey, take us here, take us there. We don't need to tell you anything. How do you want to calm down these MPs?
Honestly, I don't know what you would say to an MP to make them say, okay, well, never mind. Yeah. So
all right, it's kind of this is their job. They kind of outrank you and will do what they need to, especially during a time of war on an Air Force base. But
yeah, I said let them take us to the mayor's office, and the mayor's office will tell you that what we're doing is classified.
The mayor's cell. We can radio over there. What's your business?
I'm can I flash them ID that shows that I'm in Army intelligence?
Yeah, you could pull on your agency. You could spend a point of agency if you want to do that. But Oak or Bobby already rolled some bureaucracy there and passed. Right. So what are you saying to these guys, Bobby?
just trying to a load of whatever kind of military jargon I can to your covert. This is top secret information, national security. It's important we find somebody before they leave the country because they could be taking contaminants back to the States. So they may be trying to smuggle them out through bodies or other means, and we need to get information.
All of you?
We're all working together.
We're a unit, sir.
All right, well, there's not going to be... It's going to be a skeleton crew there this time of night, but yeah, we'll take you over to the mayor's cell, them in the offices.
Nick being in military, do we know, are we going to be able to talk to anybody there to actually get answers tonight, or do we need to wait till the morning?
There'll be like someone stationed there at all hours, like 24 hours a day. Like they said, we are at war, so they can't, like, everybody just can't go to sleep. Someone has to be stationed. There's going to be information coming and going, and planes coming and going, and helicopters, and reports, and soldiers. So someone will have to be at the administrative offices even at this time of night.
So Stan knows that that's one of the places we need to go to look for information. What kind of information?
There'll be records of... people coming and going through here. You know that he came through here roughly like 14 hours ago now, or 24 hours ago, when he had two bodies. He must have had maybe a crate with something in it, and you have a name. You can ask around to see if there's a guy who showed up from Firebase Jonas with two bodies.
I mean, yeah, ideally, well, let's ask, he's stuck trying to get out of here, right?
I'll ask the MPs. I'll say we're looking for this Air Force guy. Flew in about 12 hours ago. We're trying to find some. We're trying to find some more information on his whereabouts and some of the stuff he was. Hauling with him.
You also have the name of the corporal who's dead, who's probably waiting to be shipped back to the U.S.
Yeah, so I'll give him all that. Name of the Air Force officer.
Yeah, the MPs.
Mormon and.
Yeah, the MPs say, "Hey, this warehouse is here full of bodies. We'll take you them in. You got this. You got this fella's name. You got information. I'm sure they can help you out. You don't need to spend any points here, Stan. But they'll take you to the admin offices, and you can go in there and try to get some details."
All right, let's head that way.
All right. All right. I'm just looking at some things here that you could trigger, but all right. Well, let's go to the admin office. So you head there. It's nighttime. It's dark. There's a guard standing at the door. The military police pull up in the Jeep. They let you out. The guard asks for your ID. This is the soldier who's stationed there asks for your ID as you enter, which I'm sure you produce. Unless anybody objects. And you head on into an administrative office. There's a desk there. There's a soldier behind it. And how can I help you, gentlemen? It's a late hour to be coming in.
We just arrived. We'll be up till we get a chance to go to bed here.
So you guys can lean on agency, either Army or USMC or bureaucracy here, with dealing with these guys, with this the desk jockey.
I've already burned my 2 points of agency, so don't know if that matters.
So you can still pull on it. You just don't. You won't. You can't. Like, if there's clues in here, it'll tell me sometimes, like, if the agent spend one clue or two clues, they'll get more information. But if you'll always have that knowledge, even if you've used up your 2 of 2 and you're sitting at 0 2, you always will have agency. It just means you'll get less information if you don't spend. Does that make sense? If you spend, you'll get more details. But you'll always get details no matter what. The game won't shut you down with furthering the story.
If anybody's
going first thing first, I ask him where his Pot of Joe is.
You have 1 point in agency, Stan. It's underneath interpersonal. Pot of Joe? Because there's a kettle in the back.
Actually,
there's no way this guy's working all night with no coffee around.
There's a kettle in the break room.
I have multiple points of agency. Given my character's background, I assume that some of them are with the FBI, some are with them with the Army,
yeah,
etc. So can I draw from each and say, look?
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll shave off a point of each. I'll throw 2 points into it.
Sure.
And say, look, this is highly need to know, but we need your help. This is what we're looking for. Person claiming to be an Air Force officer by the name of Mormon. Got here about 12 hours ago with a couple of bodies. Probably tried to requisition a way out of here and a way to deliver these bodies. I need to know what you know.
Yeah, he says, hold on, 12 hours ago, 13 hours ago, let me go back to the records. And he starts flipping through them and he goes, Mormon. Yeah, he came through here. He's still in the country, but he's not at the base at present. He's expected back either tonight or tomorrow, because he left some cargo here. It's warehoused here on the base for shipment back home tomorrow night.
All right.
Looks like warehouse cargo information. Building 237 is where his items are sitting.
All right, and can you find out what did he requisition and where did he go?
Let's see here. Yeah, I should have that as well. And he starts flipping through the pages of this file. And his face kind of that information is classified. He's kind of surprised himself as he says it.
Yeah. By what authority?
He kind of flashed because you spent all the points flashing. He's just like, it's just like classified. There's like nothing. This is classified, sir. I don't know what to tell you. This does not come up very often. Must be a top secret mission for Uncle Sam.
As is ours. So unless that classification stamp has a, what would you call it? A higher priority than ours, I suggest you unseal it.
Sir, I am not taking that risk.
Well, you don't have to do it now, but what I would ask is that you put a hold on that shipment going out, one. Our superior should be making a phone call to yours soon, and we will get those records unsealed. Two. Three, if you could have some MPs help us escort us around on base so that other people won't keep asking these questions about why we're here.
We can ask for an escort. I can't guarantee anything, but that building is locked. It is sealed. Those remains are set to be sent back to the States tomorrow.
Right. And I'm countermanding that. Those remains are going nowhere as of right now.
I don't have that authority.
Who does?
The commander of this Air Force base.
All right. So our commander should be contacting him soon. So that's not an issue then. Did he draw from a motor pool to get out of here?
Affirmative. Yes.
Right. Where's your motor pool?
It's just east of here. You, all of a sudden, the phone rings, and he answers it. Yes, ma'am. Yep. Four. Yes, ma'am. And he holds up the phone and goes, "It's for you."
Sure, I'll take it.
Yeah, it's Carl sitting in, and she says, "What have you learned?"
He's still in country. He requisitioned something from the motor pool here. He's due to be back. Apparently the records are sealed, confidential. They won't give us the information as to where he went, but the bodies are here. Possibly the package is here as well, but we don't know as that information will not be given to us. I'm staring the guy down while I'm saying this.
Yeah. She says, you've said too much already. You need to keep this down. This needs to be private. We can't just march in there and take this. This is Majestic who's holding on to it. You go in there quietly and you get that. We can't use the military base. They'll be on to us if we go ahead and start pulling rank here. Remember, they're not to know who we are, that we even exist. We don't exist.
All right, fellas, let's head over to that to the warehouse.
We should go to the barracks for the night. I'm winking at you, very obvious.
Yeah, we should probably turn in for the night.
Yeah, no, I didn't say that in front of this guard.
Yeah, you guys leave. Do you thank
we
the
leave
desk jockey
leave.
For his help? Head on out. Yeah, you guys are
head out and after we're out of earshot, I say let's time for some B&E. Let's find out what was the number 271 or something?
237.
237.
Yeah, all the buildings have big numbers painted on the side, so it's not hard to track it down. It's not a secret what building is what. So you guys kind of start walking around and skulking around. There are Jeeps every once in a while driving by with MPs in them. I'm assuming you guys are kind of sticking in the shadows and trying to wait till they drive by and kind of stay out of sight. Or what do you want to do? The MPs are on duty right now. They're really the only ones milling about.
How well do they seem to be protecting this cargo hold?
You're not there yet. You're just kind of walking the base.
Actually, are they the same group that picked us up earlier?
No, you see various
okay
pairs patrolling the base. It's a huge, massive base. So there's guys driving around in Jeeps doing their rounds, their patrols.
All right, we try to look inconspicuous whenever a patrol goes by, or just get out of the line of sight.
You know? Sure.
Head our way over.
Sounds good. So you guys,
we wouldn't be lucky enough to have the cargo hold be on the way to the barracks, would we?
Are you going to the barracks, or what are you doing? Are you actively looking for barracks?
We're going to the cargo hold, but it would help if we were walking towards the barracks.
So that's our alibi.
I think we're going to get stopped because you're not supposed to be out.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's the thing.
You guys are not supposed to be out wandering around the base at night. You're going to be constantly stopped by police.
Yeah, why don't we ask for an MP escort so, again, we don't get stopped to the barracks where we're supposed to be, or where we can lodge up for the night. And then from there, we can figure out what's going on. If we're lucky, the direction to the barracks will pass near enough that we can get a good look at the hangar.
I'll tell you what, Bert, I'm going to do one of your things. Why don't you roll a D100 and high or low it? And we'll say that'll determine whether or not it's on the way to the barracks. High or low?
I'm going to go with high.
All right. All right. So, yes, you pass by building 237 on the way to the barracks. And you notice that there are two MPs stationed outside of it, standing guard. You also... Does anybody have notice and want to spend a point in notice?
Yeah, I'll spend it.
Okay, just spending a point in notice. You see that there is a closed circuit camera above the main doors.
All right. So I'll wait till we're given quarters before telling you guys this.
Sure. Yeah, so you guys get over there. Two guards and a camera.
This is not going to be easy. And multiple MPs patrolling. I'm not exactly sure how we're supposed to pull this off. We might have to cause a distraction elsewhere.
Well, we got two options. We can wait for breakfast hours to open and be the first ones going over to breakfast and stop by the cargo on the way, or we can go right now and one of you is going to have to fight me in front of the MPs.
Yeah, they did say it's not leaving till tomorrow night.
It's not leaving till when?
What they said, if I remember it correctly, didn't it, you say it's not till tomorrow evening, Matt?
Yeah, it's tomorrow. I just said tomorrow sometime. They didn't give it like day or night.
Quick question here. Who has stealth on their sheet?
I think you all do, don't you? I think everybody has some points in stealth.
Perfect. So who wants to fight me in front of the MPs?
I got 8 in stealth.
There's going to be another way in besides the front door.
I don't know. I mean, it's a hangar, man. So there shouldn't be anything but a front door.
Yes, there's only one way in. You're correct.
I don't think we're getting in there, not without drawing a lot of attention to ourselves. I think it's probably more productive to either be around the base when those things are going to be loaded onto a flight and try to get on the same flight, or figure out where he is.
First thing in the morning would be best, because if we pull the fight maneuver, then there's a minimum of 2 of us sitting in jail for the night.
All right. Head into the barracks, find a couple bunks, and call it a night.
Sure.
A couple cots. Yeah. All right, yeah, you guys sleep for the rest of the evening or the rest of the night, and you wake up bright and early in the morning. You get up, you head outside the barracks, and while there still are MPs milling about, there doesn't seem to be as many of them, and there's workers. There's soldiers, there's like mechanics, there's like flight deck crew. Milling about, and it's a hive of activity now on the base.
Blend in now.
Workers.
All right, so we'll you guys want to head over to the hangar, see if we can get in now?
Yes.
But also check the motor pool to see if we can get whoever's there to give up the information on where he went. But hangar first, yeah.
Sure. Well, you guys
Sounds like he's going to be back today, right?
Yes, he's supposed to be back today or tomorrow, was what the information you got from the admin office.
Now, can we get our contact to find out? Can we requisition a flight or a helicopter, something that we can get out of here first with this?
Yeah, you attempt to contact Carlson, and she confirms, if you acquire the parcel, we will have a Huey waiting for you to get you off the Air Force, and then we can fly you. We'll take you to Saigon, and then we'll fly you back to the States from there.
Can do we need any specific paperwork to make this look a little bit more legit so you can get to us?
To make what look legit?
That we're requisitioning somebody else's cargo.
Just negative. I can't give you. There can't be a paper trail.
Okay.
This isn't happening. Understand, soldier? It's never happened.
Understood.
The question with that then is, like, how is he hiding his trail? So, like, because Majestic is also a conspiracy.
Yes.
So who is fronting them to make him look legitimate?
I don't know that, she says, but as far as I know, there's nobody hiding what's in that building.
Okay, or can we get to a transport vehicle, like something that we could load the bodies and stuff onto? Is there one?
There's Jeeps parked about. Oh, yeah. You're walking past hangars and such, and there's Jeeps parked here and there all over the base.
Like one of those tarp-covered ones.
A tarp-covered Jeep. Why don't you go ahead and make me a... No, roll me a D100 and say high or low.
No, not a Jeep. One of those larger vehicles.
Like where I know, just like a big truck with the back on it.
Yeah, because we don't know. We're carrying two bodies and a possible, no telling how large of a cargo box.
Yeah, no, those are very common. Those are parked all about as well.
Here's an idea. Would I be able to get in touch with our contact and have her send over some information saying I need to check cargo for possible radiation?
She says, and she's still up in the range. She goes, I cannot provide you any information. We can't requisition anything. There can't be any paper trails. Can't get you anything to get you in there. You need to figure it out and get it out of there. There can't be any traces back to... We don't exist. They're going to want to know where this came from.
Chat's got us. Yeah. Deuce and a half. That's what they're called.
Deuce and a half.
All right. So when we are heading back over by the hangar, are the... What do we see? There are still two guards out there?
Are two guards posted out there, and there is a camera still out there.
The hangar door closed or open?
Hangar door is open. There's a couple Jeeps parked outside. Must be some workers inside.
Says, hey, let's take this truck and go over there and just act like we're supposed to be loading this up. This is our job. We're getting this and we're leaving.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Well, except their paperwork is going to say it leaves tonight. They're going to question why we're doing it this early. I mean, not a bad plan.
But then we talk shit and roll some dice.
I'll tell you what. You can rely on disguise, military science, or even maybe drive. So disguise, maybe get some coveralls to look like some workers. Drive to borrow a forklift and drive your way in there. Disguise yourselves. Those are all things you can pull on.
I've got three in military science.
That only work during the day. If you're trying to do this at night, there was no workers or anything, but it is during the day. So kind of looking around, there are workers milling about. There's forklifts parked. You think, oh, maybe if I, you know, I can pull off a disguise, I can go on in there and find right, it, well, take a look, and maybe load it up and get on out.
I don't have
any
disguise. Do you
guys? Two in disguise.
I got two in driving. If somebody wants to help outfit me with a disguise, I'll drive the forklift over there.
I've got drive and disguise. I mean, can I use disguise, spend several points of it to just basically snag us all uniforms that would look right?
Yes. I'll make it a higher difficulty. How about that? And that will cover everybody.
Okay. Well, if it'll cover everybody, I'll spend four.
Okay. Roll me your D6.
I'm glad I spent it. Five.
All right. So there you go. So you're able to, you find like a change room. You find some coveralls. You hand them out to the others, the right size and everything. You guys look the part. You find there's a forklift parked. And you look like you should be going in there.
I will use my two driving if you guys want for the forklift.
How about spending a bit of bureaucracy to get some paperwork that looks real official?
I got some of that as well. I will definitely spend some bureaucracy if you want. I haven't used any, and I have three as well.
All right, Doc, you got all this handled. Let's do this.
All right, roll me your D6, Doc. Doctor up some papers. Get to a typewriter and start typing. Wow. Good thing you guys are spending these points. All right, so you make up something that looks like semi-official if you flash it at the guards as you guys make your way over to building 237. They wave you in. You get there and there's a warehouse office shortly inside on the right hand side. There's an office with a door. It's wide open. There's a soldier sitting there at the desk. And there's crates everywhere. This place is just filled with crates.
All right, how do we track down the crate?
Yeah, do we have any idea of the system that they've organized with?
You don't. You can head over to the office. You can ask the fellow there.
Yeah, we'll head over to the office, let him know what we're looking for.
Hey, need to see if you can help us out here. We're looking for, look at the notepad or whatever we got, the clipboard. Look for this cargo. They've changed shipment times. We've got to get this out of here. They want it gone now instead of tonight.
Yeah, when did it arrive?
About, I'm calculating in my head, what would it be, 24 hours ago? Or 16 to 20 hours ago?
Something like that.
Yeah, hold on. And he goes, wheels over to a clipboard and starts flipping through. He goes, there are four crates that fit that time frame here. And he writes down the aisles and the crate numbers where you can find them.
Going to give whatever the guys, the military, Morris or Mormon or whatever?
Mormon, yeah. Doesn't say who these are under. Just shows that they came around that time and they're heading back to the States. Here. Can you sign for this? He holds out the
and clipboard. I want to look through it as I'm fumbling around to fake a signature.
Sure.
Is there anything with like the call sign, the tapioca pudding, whatever it was?
It was Tangent Pluto. I remember.
Is there anything with that kind of marking or a TP, capital TP on anything?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. That's a good question. There isn't. It's a very good question. But if you want, does anybody have traffic analysis when he holds out the papers for you to
sign?
I
do.
All right. If you you can spend 1 or 2 points to get to narrow it down. 1 point will narrow it down to two crates. 2 points will narrow it down to the crate that you want.
I was wondering what in the world traffic analysis is.
I know, right? For. Would you like to spend your?
I was going to say, is there like dimensions on a shipping manifest or anything like that? But
yeah, I'll spend 1 point. That's all I got.
Yeah, this narrows it. Okay, so it narrows it down to two crates that are tagged with AEC.
Now, can you
in the correct time frame?
Like, kind of assist somebody because I've got 1 point in that also. Can I spend my point on his role as well?
Yeah, so there is assisting and piggybacking, it's called. Bear with me here as I think I had it tagged in the book where it was. You can help and assist, but as from what I remember, it was like the cost of two equals like one assist. Like, how many points do you have in it?
One.
Okay. From what I remember, it was like you spend two to give him a plus one to his role.
But in this case, we're not making rolls, we're just spending points,
just
right?
Just spending points, that's true.
So can we spend points from... Can two different characters
spend points? He says, now I know this isn't it. I'm like, oh no, it's this one here.
Bear with me. Just want to see the quick roll, and I'm not against it. Don't get me wrong.
He eliminates one, then I can eliminate the other.
When two agents cooperate towards a single goal, they agree which of them is undertaking the task directly and assist. The leader may spend any number of points from their pool, adding them to the die roll. Oh, there's no die roll. Yeah, you're right. Sure. There's also piggybacking. Group of agents act in concert to perform a task together. They designate one to take the lead. That agent makes a simple test. Hey, you're not making a simple test. Sure. Two of you put your heads together and you narrow it down between your two traffic analysis clues. Narrow it down to the one crate that would be the one.
Now, does that include the bodies with it?
It looks like it is everything.
Okay. Let's drive that forklift over there. Let's go.
Yeah, but you notice. So between your two traffic analysis, you notice that there's at least one other majestic crate sitting here. Not from this operation. This looks like it may have been sitting here for a couple weeks. But there's another crate here as well.
We're going to nab that one too.
Yes, we are. Let's go to this crate first, though. Just take a note of where that second crate is.
Sure. So you go to the first crate, and it's a big square crate. It's a coffin. And you go ahead and you, do you have a crowbar or anything? Grab a crowbar? What do you want to do? What do you want to do to pry this thing open?
Don't. We're going to load it on the truck and leave.
Sure. You want to throw it on the forklift and load it on the truck?
Yep. Yep. We'll open it when it's on the truck and a little bit more covered.
Sure, sure, sure.
Yeah, helicopter.
Do we have room for the second crate as well on the truck?
Yeah, we got a big
truck. Yeah, you'd have room.
Let's grab that one too then after we grab this one.
Sure. So yeah, you load it on the truck and you guys head on out of there. And where do you want to go with it? You've got to load it on a, what was it, a deuce or whatever? Deuce and a half? Yeah,
2.5 ton.
So we look for the nearest place where we can get our extrication to be able to land. They said they could send us a what?
A Huey to get you to Saigon and then out of the country from Saigon.
All right. So I guess the closest place where we can get a Huey to land.
Yeah. Well, you're on an Air Force base. So you radio it in to Carlson and you say what? The package has been acquired.
We want to drive off
base. We
don't
know that yet. We need to open these up and make sure that we have the right thing.
Yeah, do we want to drive off base or we want to try to open these on base?
I think we're going to be stopped and searched if we try to take this off base.
No, we need to stay on base.
Yeah.
Let's just find kind of an out-of-the-way spot to double-check the crates, then wait for extrication.
Sure. Yeah, let's do a... Why don't you make me a stealth roll? Whoever's behind the wheel, make me a stealth roll.
Back behind a building somewhere.
Yeah, you want to find a place to be tucked away from prying eyes. You want to hop in the back of this deuce and a half. And
I got 8 stealth. I'll burn
park between a couple of tents.
Yeah. So go ahead and make me a stealth roll and burn how many of your points you want to. Oh, look at you. All right, so yeah, you're tucked away behind, between a couple of hangars near the back of the base. It's a quiet kind of corner, and you guys park the deuce and a half, and you get out, and you can throw in a crowbar that you grabbed in the warehouse on your way out into the back, and you've got this big coffin that's in there, and a crate as well that you grabbed. You want to pry this open?
Bobby does.
Absolutely, we're all prying this open.
Yep.
All right, so you pry open the coffin.
Insanity for everybody.
You see the remains of the soldier who took his life lying in there. The crate is packed with newspaper. And lying in the crate beside him, like around his arms around it, is a large, heavy metallic box and a sealed ammo can.
Not touching it.
Yeah, seal it up. This is the package.
Now, what about the Viet Cong guy? Is his remains here?
His remains are not in there.
We do need to confirm that we actually have the package. So if nobody else wants to, I will crack it open.
No, look, I may have already been contaminated. Let me do it.
All right. All right, so what do you want to crack open first? The large metallic box. Myself,
so.
The large metallic box or the sealed ammo can?
The sealed ammo can.
Okay,
I want to check it first to make sure it doesn't look like it's rigged with something.
Yeah, you pick it up and it's kind of heavy. You don't like shake it violently, but you kind of move it back and forth, and it feels like there's something moving in there, like something heavy, like sand or something like that. And you can also hear something rattling around in there, kind of hitting the edges of the ammo can as well when you do that.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure, check the latch, etc., that it hasn't been booby-trapped.
No, it hasn't. It hasn't. Okay. You don't need to spend any points in that.
All right. I will turn my back to the guys and tell them don't look.
Look away.
Yeah.
Sure.
And I'll pop it and take a look inside.
Yeah, you pop it open and it's filled with ashes. That's what the heavy kind of moving back and forth sand sort of sand sounding and material is. And also within the ashes, you see that there's film canisters, and it looks like that they hold negatives to photographs. Okay. And also you also find sealed in there reel to reel tape.
Okay. Does the ash, I have forensics. Does the seem like bone ash dust, like cremation dust?
Yes. If you're spending forensics, yes.
Okay.
Bet this is our Vita Conga.
Yeah. Close it up. Tell you guys what I found. Okay. We got the, we probably got the interrogation tapes. We got the film and we've got human ashes.
We need to find a projector and see what's on that film, don't we, boys?
Somebody later. Else can look at that
later. All right, so we still don't have the lantern though. So what else in this coffin might have the lantern?
There is a big metallic square box that's like his arm is around it.
I think it's safe to say that's our parcel we're after.
Yeah, we have to confirm up. Though how's the box sealed?
It's got like a clamp, like an ammo box, same sort of clamp on it.
All right. Check again to make sure he hasn't set up a trap.
Sure. Yeah, you look it over and it's clean.
All right, and pop it. Take a look.
So you pop it open, and you're in the back of this darkened.
Just before right, yeah. he pops it open, I say, "Hey, nothing against you at all. You got your back to us." I pull out my handgun and I point it at the back of his head in case he goes completely ballistic.
Oh, man.
I move my hand back and kind of center it a little bit more. That's the sweet spot. So the idea is if I pop that and I get the light that I saw from the lens, I'm not even it's slamming that lid closed, not even trying to go further if I see that light.
Yeah, you get so, that light from the crack of it. It's like, nope.
As soon as you open it, light starts to pour out. Yep, and you
nope,
see,
nope, down. You say, want me to make some kind of roll to make sure I can do that?
No. You it doesn't happen until you open it.
Uh-huh.
It opens it and you see a weirdly twisted piece of metal that is identical in shape to what was burned on your eye after looking through the camera.
As soon as I see that light, it slams shut, locked it. It's like, yeah, we've got the parcel.
Okay.
All right. While they're opening that, I'm going to open that other one the other majestic crate.
Do we want to do that? That's just a bonus package, not what we were here for. Maybe we'll get a promotion, and it could have something that could jeopardize the rest of this.
Curiosity kills the agent, man.
Yeah.
Hand it into Delta Green and call it a day. So do you want to open the other one?
Yeah, I want to go ahead and open it while I'm opening that one while they're opening.
You crack it open and this one's filled with like straw and newspaper as well, and you start throwing and tossing it about, and within the middle of this crate amongst all the straw newspapers is a wooden mask. It looks ancient and it's like a horrific, horrific mangled face that's been carved into the wood.
Guys, if there's mask, one thing I
go over and I put it on Bobby.
Throw it in Bobby.
Bobby, try this on.
I've got a story about my great 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 grandfather.
Yeah. So you've got the mask.
All right, I'll repackage the
throw it back on, kind of
roll a D100 for me.
Mask of Nyarlathotep, the crossover adventure.
Yeah, right.
Absolutely.
All right, so you guys have the package. You have the materials. You can call in for a Huey to get you out of here and to Saigon and then hopefully back to the States.
All right.
Sounds good.
Mission accomplished.
All right. So you call it in. The Huey arrives. You guys you're on edge the whole time. You kind of stay back in the shadows. You don't really make your presence known. You drive the Huey once you know it's actually touched down, but you get the packages on board. Takes you to Saigon down in the south, and mission accomplished. What do you want to do with these artifacts? Do you want to take them back to the U.S. with you? Do you want to destroy them? Do you want to leave them here? What do you want to do with these?
Aren't we turning them over to our handlers?
It was up to you. It was up to you what you want to do with these objects when you discovered them.
Then I'm gonna grab the mask one night. I'm gonna go out. I'm gonna. Drink a six pack of beer, grab the mask, grab Bobby and Doc and David and go out in the woods and try the mask on.
Wouldn't that be the perfect thing to wear to like Day of the Dead in Mexico?
Go rogue. Yeah, go rogue with these materials. So long, Stan. Yeah. Well, that's a tale for another day if you want to put that mask on. It's a tale for another day. And that takes you to the end of the little one shot in the back of the book of Fall of Delta Green, Operation Aladdin's Cave, it's called. It's hence the lamp. I will tell you the kind of like aftermath of this. So I'll read you here. If the agents or Mormon bring the lamp back to the US, things aren't so nice. The agents bring the lamp to Delta Green. The handler decides whether it corrupts Delta Green and contributes to the program's eventual manic self-destruction in 1970, or perhaps Delta Green destroys it on the no artifact is a good artifact principle. Majestic, of course, tries to weaponize it, recognizing its light and gravity and metallicity as sort of like the Roswell saucer, or at least something else just as good. This definitely contributes to their gleeful willingness to sell the human race down the river in the 1980s and the 1990s. The Mego. So the Mego, M-I-G-O, is a race of aliens. They are the true puppet masters who are trying to take over the human race. That's more Delta Green lore. The Mego, by the way, recognize the lamp as a dampening rod of sorts for the Gantuboa and demand it from Majestic at some point in the future. Firebase Jonas is reported overrun by enemy action, and B-52s fly again. More of the jungle becomes moonscaped. The cave collapses in the second, much worse bombing, while you guys did that for it. Slowly, the world goes mad, goes corrupt, becomes unable to recognize its own dark reflection in the madman across the cave in the flickering light. And that is the end of this. Ideally, you're supposed to return it to the tunnels and seal it in there. But you guys sealed the tunnels and you took it back to the U.S. And you guys kind of just helped accelerate the eventual downfall of Delta Green of in mankind. 1970.
I don't think we would have actually taken it back. I think we would have. Well, I mean, I know the FBI agent would have voted for blowing it all up. But I mean, if it was left to us, getting it into the States would have been a hassle. So
it would have. Yeah.
That's... I'm all voting for we destroy those things.
Drop it in the ocean somewhere.
Yeah, I was just thinking, drop it in the ocean on the way over.
Yeah, real deep where some like octopus creature could get up.
Yeah, where the deep ones, the great old ones are slumbering.
Yep. Cthulhu 2.
So if this were an ongoing, this is where you could like pull on your bonds to get some stability back and maybe even get some sanity back. And you could develop and gain more skills and things like that, but... I think it's a neat little system. I like the gumshoe system. I like how it's clue-based and it's a mystery, and there's no guarantee of failure. It's going to happen. It's just, do you want to spend points to accelerate getting those clues and getting more clues? Between sessions, you get all your points back. As you're playing through a session also, you'll typically get like 2 general points back for your general skills, like between scenes and things like that, but you guys are clipping at a good rate and you never came to the point where you needed to get your general skills back, but you don't get your specialty abilities back, like the clue related ones where you never have to roll. Those ones you don't get back until the end of the adventure.
I think we might have realized it's a one shot and just started spending everything we could.
Hey, that's the way to go. If you guys went back to the cave, it also resulted in a shootout with the Viet Cong and the zombies, but hey, we didn't go in that direction. It didn't play out that way, so whatever. You guys just blew up the tunnels and the zombies within it.
Hey, it was nice to see some faces and put them to the voices. It was fun, guys. Thank you.
Yeah.
So hopefully you enjoyed it. Back to the normal Cthulhu?
Back to Cthulhu next Sunday. I think everybody's back. So, I think we're going to wrap up New York. Tuesday, we're going to go back to Tiny Dungeon. We'll get back into that. And Friday is not going to be Forbidden Lands. Friday, I'm actually going to run Dark Astral. Jeff, who is in the chat here, has written us a special adventure. Dark Astral is what Zweihänder is to Warhammer, is what Zweihänder is to Warhammer 40K. So we're going to be doing a Warhammer 40K using Zweihänder rules adventure over the next few weeks on Fridays.
And that's on Fridays, eh?
That's on Fridays. That Jeff has written for us, and he's going to sell on DriveThruRPG afterwards. So we're going to have exclusive first crack at the adventure, and we're going to do some Warhammer 40K. but using Zweihänder. It's called Dark Astral.
Thanks to the game, guys. Thank you, Matt.
Yeah, thank you to everybody who tuned in and joined us for this one shot. And yeah, we'll be back on Tuesday. Thank you to the players.
Thanks, guys.
Have a good night.
Thanks for watching, everyone.